Thank you, Aaron, and a big welcome to Morgantown. West Virginia started the season 5-0. Hit a rough stretch. The Mountaineer fans, they believe in their quarterback, Geno Smith, and they hope for a turnaround today against TCU. On a cool day in Morgantown, it's TCU and West Virginia on Fox. Frank Bullerjack along with Joel Klatt, so glad you're with us. Remember 3 weeks ago, West Virginia was on top of college football. They've hit a struggle. Now the question, Joel, is can Geno bring them back to the mountaintop?
Well, if he's going to, he's got to start having some fun. And that's what the first five games of the season was for Geno Smith. That was fun. 80% completion percentage, no interceptions, 24 touchdown passes. He was riding high. He was the Heisman Trophy front runner. Hit a bit of a rough patch in the last couple of games. 58% and two interceptions. If he just gets back to cutting it loose and having fun, I think he's going to have a big game. For TCU, Gary Patterson brings his Horned Frogs into the Big 12 Conference, and they're going through some growing pains right now. A lot of success in the last three seasons, and right now, after a couple of losses, Gary Patterson is trying to avoid his first three-game losing streak in his career at TCU as head coach. A couple of teams trying to right the ship. Something's got to give today.
TCU and West Virginia, a battle from the Big 12, and it's next on Fox. Welcome to Fox College Football, presented by Reese's. Back in Morgantown, West Virginia, Milan Puskar Stadium. Petros Papadakis, our sideline insider, and P. Many questions this week concerning the health of TCU quarterback Trevon Boykin.
That's right, Bowler. He tweaked his knee a little bit against Oklahoma State, and incidentally, that was his worst performance of the year. This guy is doing great on-the-job training, filling the shoes of Casey Paha, but he's made some mistakes. He's a dual threat. Sometimes he's way up, sometimes he's way down. Gary Patterson says he'll be great as long as he doesn't try to play the game like Joe Namath.
I like the analogy. Gary Patterson, there he is, 12th year in Fort Worth. TCU's all-time winningest coach, and his counterpart today is Dana Holgorsen, Big East and Orange Bowl champs a year ago. And Joel, as we talked about, both these schools making the jump this year to the Big 12.
It's been a bumpy road for both of them, both Dana and Gary Patterson, trying to right the ship here today.
West Virginia won the toss. They chose to receive, and that kick bounds into the end zone. So here comes Geno Smith and company, and let's check today's impact players.
Sean Alston is going to play today at the running back position. He hasn't played in quite some time, had a deep thigh bruise, but he should be back in there and should give their running game quite a big boost. Carl Joseph, one of their defenders, a true freshman, second leading tackler on the team, savvy young player in the back end. For TCU, Josh Boyce, career leader in touchdown catches, a Biletnikoff Award watch list guy. He's the most dangerous on the outside for TCU.
So here's Geno as they start on the 25-yard line. West Virginia and TCU here on Fox. Geno Smith over the middle, he goes, and just having fun, and he finds his wide receiver, Tavon Austin. That's his 75th reception of the season. He's a senior out of Baltimore. Mountaineers like to run the hurry up. Andrew Bowie in the backfield alongside Geno. Four wide receivers set. They pick up nine. Second down short on a play action. Quick throw and a drop right on the hands of Jordan Thompson, the freshman from Katy, Texas. That was a free play, Joel, and they couldn't convert. Third down and one.
Now a big conversion down. Got to move the sticks.
Shotgun. Geno Smith flares it out to the flat on the hands of Bowie. And good pursuit by TCU. They stretch the field, looks to be short. Derek Kindred, the strong safety, and let's see where the mark is. Yeah, they're going to move the chains.
Just got the corner on the outside in order to move the chains, and West Virginia at a breakneck pace so far early. Trying to get TCU lined up, snap the ball as quick as they can.
Smith trying to hit a hot slant. That ball ricochets off of the hands of McCartney. And again, Kindred in on that play, number 26, along with Olabode. So it's hurry up for West Virginia. A little shovel, Austin. Can he turn the corner? And again, TCU trying to string it out. And they do, down to the 34-yard line. Verrett, the corner.
Going to be real tough for West Virginia to just get the edge with those little jet sweep type plays because of the disciplined nature with which TCU plays defense. Always in the right spot.
They spread the field with five wide receivers. Underneath again is Austin. And TCU looks prepared at the 39-yard line. And TCU's defense, Petros, right now looks to have good timing on the field.
Yeah, they're tackling well. And that's been the key to playing against West Virginia, guys. You have to be a sure tackler. You can't let Tavon Austin break a tackle and take off down the middle of the field. Joel, to me right now, TCU looks more like Kansas State than they do Baylor.
Yeah, very efficient on defense. They just line up in the same spot. Go tackle the ball carrier once that ball is completed in front of them.
Tyler Bittenkirk will punt. And gets it up in a high hanger. And oh, a dangerous fair catch at the 31-yard line by Sky Dawson. Impact players, Joel, for TCU.
Yeah, Josh Boyce, I was talking about earlier, the wide receiver. He's the career leader in touchdown catches. Biletnikoff Award watch list player, the most dangerous guy on the outside. And then Stanley Mapunga. He's been injured. He's a terrific defensive end. He's going to be in there on passing situations, and I think he's going to create a lot of problems for West Virginia today because they don't protect the passer all that well. That's why you saw a lot of those short, tight passes getting the ball out of Geno Smith's hand early on that first series.
We'll see how Trevon Boykin responds after being banged up last week against Oklahoma State. He is a runner by trade, and he falls forward for about a 2-yard gain to the 34-yard line. And there's Mr. Boykin, quarterback in high school, a terrific runner, nearly 1,800 yards his senior year. I like what Petros talked about earlier. All the coaches say, look, don't try to win it with your arm. Don't be Joe Namath. Just go out and run the football.
They just want him to manage the game, and that's when he's been at his best for Gary Patterson and this TCU team, is when he just takes what's there. If it's there to run it, go ahead and run it. If you've got the completion, go ahead and sling it out there accurately.
Wants to throw. Now he can tuck and run. Very dangerous. Nice cut. And another. And he always is tripped up at the 40-yard line, a couple yards shy of the first down by Pat Miller. So we see early if Boykin's left knee will hold up, and made a nice cut. Looks to have a nice smooth gait.
I don't see any ill effects from that knee injury from last week against Oklahoma State. A couple of cuts on both legs. Gets himself into a manageable third down situation. That's the type of run right there that Patterson was talking about. Get our team in a position where we can convert. He's done that. Now he needs to make a play on third and two.
They bring in the double tight set with Fuller and Gilbert. Matthew Tucker in the backfield into the heart of West Virginia. And I think the crowd and the team points the other way as they hold. They'll bring up fourth and about 1.5. George Wright, number 99, leading the cheers here in Morgantown.
How about this crowd on their feet for the West Virginia defense, the much maligned West Virginia defense. Haven't had a lot of success during the course of this season, and to get off the field, their crowd acknowledging the effort that the Mountaineer defense gives on the first series. That was good to see right there.
And Ethan Perry, the top punter in the Big 12, number 6 in the nation at 47 per kick, lets it fly, and Austin is knocked down after the fair catch at the 19-yard line. No first downs in Morgantown. Scoreless on Fox. In the aftermath of natural disasters like Superstorm Sandy, the American Red Cross provides life-saving services such as meals, shelter, and mobilizing resources and workers nationwide. You can visit redcross.org or text Red Cross to 90999 to give a $10 donation. And the folks here in Morgantown, fortunate that Hurricane Sandy just kind of slid past, but they did see some snow. But our thoughts are with those in the Northeast. As the ground game gets started with Dustin Garrison on this second series, and Joel, will see if they do the hurry up. West Virginia, of course, started 5-0. Two straight losses have followed, and they have to wonder if this bye week helped fix the problem. with the Geno Smith offense. He throws near side, simple pitch and catch. It's on the hands of McCartney to move the chains. First down for West Virginia, 35-yard line.
TCU's going to be just fine letting West Virginia catch the ball in front of them all day long and then try to rally up for the tackle. Looks like base defense on every single snap so far of the game, Craig.
Garrison went airborne, and Koontz was there, along with a host of defensive front Horned Frogs for TCU. They are very tough against the run. Average, they allow less than 99 yards a ball game. On second down and 10, no gain. Smith. That ball may have been deflected. It was out of the backfield to Garrison, the running back, number 29. Incomplete. Third down and 10. And bringing pressure was David Johnson, number 53.
Devontae Fields was also a guy that was pressuring that pocket, putting some outside pressure onto Geno Smith, number 95, the true freshman. A heck of a player. Leads the Big 12 in tackles for loss and sacks.
Third down and 10, Geno Smith sets and fires underneath. And TCU is happy to give him the short stuff, buoy the catch, but well short of the first down. So for the second straight time, West Virginia will punt.
And this is a page straight out of what Kansas State did to West Virginia. And that was play really soft coverage, base defense, two safeties deep in the field. Gary Patterson saw that film and he says, that's exactly how I'm going to attack this offense. And they've had a lot of success early in the first two series.
Tyler Bittenkurtz, first punt, 29 yards. He'll be at his own 25. Low snap. This time gets it away, end over end, and takes a big bounce at the 25 and rolls to the 22-yard line. That's where TCU will go back to work. Scoreless here in Morgantown. Defensively, I tell you, TCU bringing the hammer on West Virginia early. Fox College Football is sponsored by Reese's Peanut Butter Cups, the perfect combination of chocolate and peanut butter. Well, last three-game losing streak, TCU and West Virginia. It just doesn't happen often. TCU, 1998, that was 3 years before Gary Patterson became the head coach. And, well, last time for West Virginia, got to turn the clock back to 2004.
It's interesting because both of them in the first game of those two-game losing streaks, it happened against Texas Tech. Obviously, West Virginia coming off of a bye, looking to end that two-game skid. TCU's never had another pass.
Boykin takes a direct snap, and he flies off to the far side, picks up five, and knocked down by Cecil Level.
I like that play call because with a young quarterback, we've already seen him have the ability to run successfully against this West Virginia defense. But why not do it on first down, and now you set yourself up for the rest of the downs within this series. Now Boykin has an opportunity at second and five, looks like maybe even second and four. Not a lot of pressure on this type of a down.
On a rollout, slingshots it. Near side, pitch and catch on the hands of Dawson, his 28th reception. This guy is a speedster. If you don't tackle him, Dawson will break away. He's a 10-2, 100-meter man.
Two-time Mountain West track champion. And watch Boykin on the run deliver this ball accurately. And that's the type of play that then is afforded you as a play caller once you get 5 yards on first down. Makes it much easier on everybody, including your quarterback. Makes it easier on the offensive line. You get that quarterback outside of the pocket. That's a great first set of downs for TCU on this second series.
Four wide receiver set. They hand it off to Dawson. They'll try to hit the edge. He'll take his sixth carry of the year to about the 40, call it the 48-yard line.
This is a group that has had to completely change their identity, Petros. Casey Paul early, and now Trevon Boykins late in the season.
It seems like they'll be able to run the football and control it with Boykin as long as they don't make mistakes. They could really eat some clock and keep Geno Smith on the sideline, Joel.
They pick up six as the clock actually rolls up on 8 minutes. Here's the corner, handed off, Andre Dean. The senior, high school All-America out of Katy, Texas, a transfer out of UCLA. So they're mixing it up. Third down and two. They're third best in the nation. As Petros, Joel talked about chewing clock, they chew a lot of clock.
Well,
They do it by converting on third down, holding on to the football, and a big down right now early in this game for Trevon Boykin.
B.J. Catalan, the freshman, number 23, right alongside Boykin. And Boykin passed the first down marker with about a half a yard to spare. And tackled by Isaiah Bruce.
How about that push up front from the offensive line? Doing a nice job of getting the edge cut down. Watch the end. Collins, the tackle here on the outside, and he gets on the outside and then cuts down the linebacker. That's the block that allows Boykin to cut up into the middle and ultimately get that first down. So it's just a short yardage run, but good execution on the up front offensive line from 69 Collins.
TCU inside West Virginia territory. Matthew Tucker now in the backfield for the Horned Frogs. Boykin wants to throw, steadies his feet. He can run, cuts it 50, and then back to the line of scrimmage. Maybe a half a yard to the 48 and a half. Isaiah Bruce with another tackle. The strong side inside backer.
It's a nice start for West Virginia after a first down. Creating a play where they get TCU behind schedule. An open field tackle for the Mountaineers, something that they've worked on all week long with the bye week, getting those offensive players down to the ground in the open field. They've struggled with that mightily, but now they've got an opportunity to put pressure on the quarterback at second and nine.
Four on the play clock, it's down to two, just got the snap away. They go option, they ride Tucker into the line, lost a hat. So that means out for a play.
Josh Francis stepped up and made the tackle, lost his hat, so he does have to come out for a play, and it'll be a big down, a third and long situation. This was all set up by the quality tackle on first down, and now a young redshirt freshman on the road on third down.
Crowd has come alive here at Morgantown. Under 6 minutes of play, fast-moving first quarter. Boykin, shotgun, slings it, wide open. Inside the 40-yard line is Josh Boyce. Boyce is the TCU career leader in touchdown receptions with 20. That is now 29 straight games that Boyce has made a reception.
Well, and third down defense has not been a strength of West Virginia. 52% conversions they're giving up. That's 117th in the country, and it's because of defense like that. Just all the time in the world for the quarterback, lots of cushion for the wide receiver, and it's the best wide receiver that TCU has, Josh Boyce. Just no pressure by the Mountaineers defense on a critical third down.
Grabbed his 45th catch of the season before the pads are popping. Matthew Tucker took on the whole front line of West Virginia and earns two yards the hard way to the 31.
Yeah, hard-nosed drive right now. You know, the only real big play that Boykin has had to make from the pocket is that last third down conversion to Boyce. Other than that, they've been chewing up the clock, chewing up the yardage. They've run option both to the short side and the wide side, and that offensive line seems to be developing a little bit of a rhythm right now against the Mountaineer front.
This will be the 10th play of this drive, and the clock is about 5 minutes in. Second down, 7. Play clock at 6. Boykin looks one way or the other. That ball is out of his hands. It's still loose. And TCU, they cover up at the 29-yard line. We'll see it on the replay. I don't know if that ball was deflected or that ball just popped out of his hand.
Yeah, I think it popped out of his hand when he reached back to throw it. As we take another look, I don't think his hand was moving forward. It just on the backswing, if you will, it falls out of his hand. Boy, that was awful close, kind of right at the transition between going forward and still going up. They ruled it a fumble, and now TCU fortunate that they were able to get the recovery.
Third down and 8. Again, the crowd comes alive. 5 on the play clock. It's down to 4, and they got it away. Low snap. Boykin stands, pressured. Oh, beautiful catch. They're going to rule it complete. 24-yard line, and how about the stretch of Josh Boyce?
Well, it was a great play by Josh Boyce, but Boykin got drilled in the pocket. You talk about a young kid standing tall. Kyle Rose comes in and bang, right in the sternum, and he delivers a great ball on the outside.
Well, look at this camera right on top of it. Boyce, second reception. He had seven grabs in that loss to Oklahoma State last week for 74 yards. And he's been a big factor so far in this series. Andre Dean checks in the backfield for TCU. Fresh downs, first and 10 at the West Virginia 24. Wide open, over the middle, inside the five goes Brandon Carter. And again, a soft coverage in the secondary for the Mountaineers.
And the rhythm from the quarterback Boykin hitting his wide receiver, Brandon Carter, in rhythm. Watch, right when he turns out of his break, that ball is in the air, on target, on the chest. No one even close to Brandon Carter. And now first and goal for the Horned Frog.
13th play of this drive. It's covered 76 yards. Boykin's been perfect from the air. On the ground, pushing the pile, and a touchdown, TCU. Matthew Tucker rumbles in for his third touchdown, and the Horned Frogs strike first.
What a methodical drive there, set up by a couple of just beautiful passes thrown by the redshirt freshman, Trevon Boykin. The offensive line taking care of things late, punching it in for the first touchdown of the game.
VAT chip shot for Overcrome, the freshman from Arlington. And TCU, impressive drive. It was fueled by this great grab by Boyce. And then Tucker took it in behind his big front line. And the Horned Frogs up 7 on Fox. Fox College Football is sponsored by Bud Light. It's a sure sign of a good time. Here we go. By the all-new Dodge Dart. Dodge, new rule. And by Firestone, reminding you that whatever you drive, drive a Firestone. You won't see a more efficient drive in college football. 13 plays, 78 yards, and Tucker went in from 2 yards out.
And the three passes, two on third down, the one to Carter to get him inside the five. That was a beautiful drive by a redshirt freshman quarterback. That's exactly what Gary Patterson wanted to see early in the game. Had the opportunity to scramble and run. Got a first down with his feet, but then he sat in the pocket and made some throws down the field.
Overcrome will kick away. And no return off the hands of Austin, about 8 yards deep. So here we go for the third time. We'll see Geno Smith. It's been a struggle thus far. Two possessions, just 34 yards of offense for the Mountaineers. TCU up by 7. I love this one. Fourth-ranked Oregon looking to keep their national title hopes alive. They will rumble with 17th-ranked USC. Coverage of Fox College Football presented by Reese's. That begins next here on Fox. After our game between TCU and West Virginia. Third series of the afternoon for Geno Smith. Sean Alston with the carry, maybe 3 yards. Let's get a game break. Back to Los Angeles and Patrick O'Neill.
Great, thank you. Missouri trying to upset Florida down in the swamp, down 14-7, but James Franklin throws his fourth pick of the day. Gators hang on, but they do not control their destiny in the SEC. Craig and Joel.
So 14-7 Gators in the swamp. The crowd gave Alston a nice round of applause. He's been out four straight with a deep, deep thigh bruise. And this time it's Bowie, the ball carrier. And he was running behind his center, Joe Madsen.
There's Sean Alston, number 20. He's got the knee brace on the right leg, but he was suffering from that thigh bruise, trying to get back. Their run game should get much better with him in the backfield.
Third down and 3. Mountaineers need to push the chains for a first down. Under 2 minutes of play in the first quarter. Geno Smith dancing his feet. You can see him just kind of impatient, and that ball is incomplete. Olabode, terrific job coming up from his free safety spot to bat that ball away.
I thought that ball was thrown late by Geno Smith because Tavon Austin was sitting on the sideline for quite some time waiting for that ball, and that's what allowed Olabode to come get over the top and bat that ball away before it got to Austin. So Geno's got to find his rhythm right now on offense. This Mountaineer offense doesn't look anything near what they were when we were here a few weeks ago when they played Baylor.
Benton Kurt, third punt. here in this quarter. Takes a bounce inside the 30. And West Virginia covers up. Now they're pointing that someone or a TCU player touched that ball on a bounce. The officials say no, and the ball is going to be placed down to the 25-yard line.
There was a TCU player blocking downfield, and I think West Virginia thought that it might have bounced into him. That's a tough look. Very difficult to see if that actually touched. Gamble there, number 16.
Copeland came in to jump on it, but it's going to be Horned Frog football, 25-yard line. They're up by 7 as we roll up on a minute to play in the opening quarter. So far, so good for Boykin. He wants to throw, looks one way and the other. Great protection and slings that ball out of bounds. Good coverage downfield, force that throw out of bounds. As we look at Big 12 standings, Kansas State, can anyone beat the Wildcats?
I'm not sure. I mean, they're just so good. They got the 2-game lead, which is essentially a 3-game lead without the championship game after beating Oklahoma in Norman earlier this year. Oklahoma did take care of business today, beat Iowa State up in Ames, but Kansas State just looks so good. They're so sound. Yeah, the West Virginia coaches, you should have heard them raving about the Wildcats having played them 2 weeks ago.
Probably one of the most fundamentally sound football programs in the country. TCU on the run. West Virginia seems like defensively, Joel, a little bit more of a more confident pack.
Well, they're trying. You know, last drive, though, they just had some plays made against them, and it started with the quarterback, Trevon Boykin. And then late, Tucker gets into the end zone. He's been battling a bit of an injury with his ankle, trying to get healthy. This whole Horned Frog team trying to get healthy, and it helps when your quarterback steps up and plays to the level that Boykin has early in this game. 4-5 for 58 yards. Plus, he's been doing it on the ground with his feet. 6 rushes for close to 20.
Pedals back, pressure, escapes, tripped up, and a flag is down back at the 18-yard line. And the swagger has come back here late in the quarter for West Virginia's D.
There's the flag down. It came in late. Looks like it might be a hold, Craig, against TCU.
Holding offense, number 69. Penalties declined.
Avion Collins, a true freshman at the right tackle spot, as we hear from Scott Novak, our referee, for the first time today.
Avion Collins, first offensive lineman to start for Gary Patterson as a true freshman in his career at TCU. Very talented kid. They beat a lot of really high-profile teams, including the University of Alabama, on Avion Collins. They're very excited about him, but still going through some growing pains as a true freshman on the front.
Well, they reset the game clock from 15 to 22. It brings up a punting situation on 4th and 16. Ethan Perry at his own 5-yard line. Here comes West Virginia, bringing the house. Just got the kick away. High bouncer. And it's taken at the 34-yard line by Tavon Austin. Today, our Fox Sports broadcasters and college football head coaches around the country, they're wearing commemorative label pins to celebrate National College Football Day. Joel, 143 years ago in New Brunswick, New Jersey, a game unlike anything seen before was played as Rutgers defeated Princeton. You know the final? 6-4. The players that day left a lasting legacy that would evolve into intercollegiate football that we know today.
I did not know that score.
6-4. Should be the final play of the quarter, up high, and the catch is made by Austin near a first down. And we'll see if West Virginia can't get going offensively in quarter number 2. 15 minutes are done. TCU on the road, up by 7. On the Mountaineers, Craig Bullerjack back along with Joel Klatt. Very important series for Geno Smith. The first 3 series, all punts in the first quarter.
And this offense in the first 5 games of the year, I mean, they were They were the best offense in the history of college football. Geno had thrown 24 touchdowns, no interceptions, and they have not found any of that rhythm since then. Last two games, Geno Smith 58%, couple of interceptions, and now they're having a hard time against this TCU defense, and they've got to him again, getting quarterback to the ground.
Tripped him up around the ankles, led by big number 97, John Koontz. We got a flag down at the 45.
Holding on the defense, number 17. 10-yard penalty, first down.
So in the secondary, it's Sam Carter, strong safety, number 17. And that's going to move West Virginia inside TCU territory, Joel, 47-yard line.
Penalties have been a problem for TCU this year, and this is such a young team. There's only one senior in the two deep on the defense.
On the rollout, Geno Smith hooks off Andrew Bowie out of the backfield. And they'll knock him down at the 44-yard line.
Petros, this TCU D, very young.
They're young, but they're not unsound. And I'll say this, their offense is playing defense for them. TCU held the ball most of the first quarter. Joel, how does Geno Smith get a swagger back from the sideline?
Yeah, it's really tough, especially because of how cold it is. Petros, I know you know standing down there, it's difficult, right? I mean, it's cold, and when TCU goes on a long drive, you got to get yourself active, ride the bike, throw the football back there. But that's a very difficult proposition for a quarterback.
Now Geno looking now at third down and 5. 1 of 4 today on third down conversions. They load the top of your screen with three wide receivers. Three-step drop. Geno Smith flushed. He's going to have to tuck and run. Sidestep for tackle and a first down. Geno Smith unable to throw the ball. So he uses his legs, and the Mountaineers move the chains.
And Kevin White, the corner, number 25, he had him. Dead to rights in front of the chains, and Geno Smith made a great athletic move, got away from him, and got the conversion.
Fresh downs for the Mountaineers. They throw it out of the backfield, pitch and catch on the hands of Bowie. He lowers his pads after about a pickup of 8 yards.
Watch this move, and Geno Smith, not much of a runner, but on the outside, this is Kevin White in front of him, and he gives him the juke, then the spin, the half spin, gets to the side, and gets the conversion.
Alston. Another first down. Alston a little slow getting up. As we mentioned, he had the thigh injury. He's got the knee brace on, and he's looks like maybe he's limping a little bit right now.
But gutting it out. The senior from Hampton, Virginia, trying to help his club move the football.
First and 10, 22-yard line. Smith stands, throws up top. Wrestled that football away, or that was an interception. Olabo had good coverage on Woods. And J.D. Woods with a touchdown, his third of the season. And the PAT by Bittencourt. He's now 40 of 41, and we're tied in Morgantown. J.D. Woods, a 22-yard touchdown reception. And it ties this game at 7 after a 7-play, 67-yard drive.
Olabode had this thing. I mean, from the ball, from the moment that the ball left Geno Smith's hand, I thought it was going to be an interception. I thought Hackett, number 1, and Olabode, number 6, were going to have an opportunity at that ball, and J.D. Woods comes up with it. This is Geno in the pocket. He paid a little bit of the price for getting that ball off. I'm just glad one of his legs didn't get locked underneath him. You know, that's one of those things that's always dangerous. You're going to get rolled up on. Unfortunate for Geno Smith, his legs went out from under him. Now 10 of 15 on the day, 72 yards and a touchdown. J.D. Woods, I think, is going to have to step up, because it's pretty clear that Stedman Bailey is the nation's leading touchdown catcher with 14 touchdowns coming into today's ball game. He isn't right. You know, he's been their down the field threat, and he's been injured trying to get back from an ankle injury. And J.D. Woods is going to have to step up, and he did so in a huge way on that last series for a touchdown.
Corey Smith hasn't teed up, and West Virginia will kick away to TCU. We're tied at 7. And no return. No return. Well, Fox Sports is your home for the UFC beginning on Friday with a new episode of The Ultimate Fighter on FX. Next Saturday is UFC on Fuel TV 6 live from Macau, China. Then on Saturday, December 8th, the UFC returns to broadcast television with the UFC on Fox 5, where Benson Henderson will put his lightweight championship on the line against Nate Diaz. Fox Sports, the place to turn for hard-hitting UFC action, and it's all year long. Seven our score. This under 13 and a half minutes of play and a half. Nice run by Andre Dean. Down at the 31-yard line.
That ball popped out, Craig, but they ruled him down. I think it was absolutely the correct call. Looked like he actually hit and slid before the ball popped out. And how about TCU now working with Will Temple?
Yeah, they waste no time. Dean hits a pile, maybe a yard. Jared Barber, number 33, made the initial hit.
That's always the problem for me with a team that's not used to going fast, and then they try to go fast, and a lot of times there's too many missed assignments because the players are not used to working at that tempo. So all of a sudden, a great first down play gets negated with no gain on second down, and you're stuck in a crucial situation at 3rd and 3.
2 of 5 on third down conversions for TCU. They need 3 yards to move the chains. And now timeout call. You make a great point. If you're not used to the hurry up and you try to throw it in, it can get you off center a bit. 7-7 our score in Morgantown. Fox College Football is sponsored by AT&T, the nation's largest 4G network. AT&T, rethink possible. Well, the bell tolls in Morgantown. You know what that means. Third down.
Never seen Dana Holgorsen as animated as he's been with his defense. He desperately wants this defense to get off the field here.
Third down and 3. Pitch it out. Cavalon. And again, a very stout West Virginia defense holds TCU, led by Cecil Level. That is now 2 straight 3-and-outs. And West Virginia holds and forces 4th and 1.
There's the coaching staff elated with their defense. This defense comes in 115th in scoring defense, 114th in total defense, and Dana Holgorsen says, nice job, fellas. Get us that ball back.
Nice punt, Perry. Austin trying to find a little seam, spin, but he's going the wrong way. He started at the 21. He's going to end up down at the 16-yard line. Well, West Virginia's defense confidence has slowly returned. 7-7 our score in Morgantown. Back in Morgantown, and it's time for the Aflac trivia question. Joel, only Heisman Trophy winner in TCU history.
Got a good idea.
Think about it. Have the answer for you just a little bit later.
I don't want to spoil it for all the viewers out there, you know. We're now quickly typing away on their smartphones.
That's one way to find out, right?
The Google machine.
West Virginia will start at the 16-yard line. 1st and 10. 12 minutes remaining first half. Gino all day to throw. Airs it deep across the middle up top and throws it. Intercepted. At the 35, Barrett the corner, and that ball hung, and he runs it back to the 45-yard line. We got a flag down midfield, 26-yard line.
After the interception, personal foul, unnecessary roughness on West Virginia number 77. 15-yard penalty will be added to the dead ball spot. First down.
Josh Jenkins, the left guard, on a personal foul. And Geno Smith just threw his third pick of the season.
And this was a bad interception. This is the route. It's going to be a post route, and it's double cover from the top of the screen. A big play action fake in the backfield, and nobody bites. The TCU defense doing a great job of staying with the route. It gets passed off to the safety, and an easy interception for TCU. That was an ill-advised throw for Geno Smith. He cannot throw that ball in that situation.
Penalty puts the ball for TCU at the 30-yard line. Up top, man coverage wide open. On the hands, touchdown, Boyce. Oh, does TCU make West Virginia pay after the interception? Boykin to Boyce, and they're up 13-7.
And Boyce adds another touchdown to his record-setting career. The TCU leader in touchdowns caught, and that one was easy. Very creative play action pass in the backfield. That's a nice creative way of getting people open in the back end. Dana Holgorsen cannot be happy. Gets the third down stop. His quarterback turns the ball over and then watches his defense get a touchdown thrown on it on the very next snap.
Fox College Football is sponsored by Pizza Hut, make it great, and by Chevrolet. From kickoff to the last yard, Chevy runs deep. Beautiful view of Morgantown, West Virginia. Yeah, there's some snow in the hills. That was courtesy of Hurricane Sandy. A lot of rain in the area as well, but nothing like it was up north.
Trevon Boykin and TCU really taking advantage of bad mistake by Geno Smith and Petros. Dana Holgorsen was livid with his quarterback coming off the field.
He didn't like the throw. He didn't like how it hung up there, Joel. And he really didn't like the fact that Geno Smith didn't chase the ball and didn't jog off the field. Very animated is Dana Holgorsen. Now, he usually is, but he's been animated with both sides of the ball with West Virginia today, especially on defense. I think he feels the pressure of this losing streak for the Mountaineers. They didn't expect this.
Well, MP, he should be limited. A lack of effort should always be criticized by a coach. That's the only way you keep your credibility.
Overthrown the kick, taken by Austin, hits the edge, breaks the tackle, 25-30. High steps, oh, stops and goes, and he's out of bounds at the 31-yard line. Little nifty move on that far side.
He is special as a return man. He got them started offensively, or at least on the scoreboard against Kansas State. They were getting beat badly in the first half, and he took a kick back 100 yards against the Wildcats. How about this move? I mean, just to stop on a dime like that, he actually stepped out of bounds. But that's just incredible athleticism. He's their weapon right now because Stedman Bailey is just not right. Number three, their wide receiver, is the nation's leading touchdown catcher with 14 touchdowns. He's just not right. They got to get the ball to Tavon Austin in space.
This drive will start at the 34-yard line. They load up the backfield. Let's see what type of approach Geno Smith goes. This time on the ground, Alston, as we mentioned, banged up. He'll pick up two past the 35-yard line.
I tell you, my respect for Sean Alston is going through the roof because you can tell he is hurting right now with that thigh bruise. Limping in motion right now and yet still out there.
Smith throws underneath and a first down. That ball comes out. They're going to rule it now incomplete. So J.D. Woods, who had that touchdown catch, takes a hit from Kevin White and loses it. Incomplete.
Petros, there's just no rhythm right now. They tried a little curl route, but TCU is always there. They're just fundamentally sound in the right spot.
Joel, how do they get the ball downfield? Their longest play from scrimmage was 13 yards against Kansas State. How does West Virginia get it downfield like they've been doing?
Now, I don't know if they can. They tried on that last series. It backfired tremendously with that interception. They got to keep it underneath to a guy like Baylor, Tavon Austin.
Underneath they go. First down, Copeland, the freshman. His fifth reception of the season. Now, Stedman Bailey is such a dynamic player. He's out with an ankle or unable to go at this moment.
I haven't even seen him on the field.
Copeland, nice catch in the chains at the 49-yard line at TCU. Geno Smith, good protection, throws in traffic. dangerous toss, but it's completed the 44-yard line.
Bailey is the top wide receiver. He's at the top of the screen, and we just haven't had an opportunity to say his name at all whatsoever. Top of your screen, there he is, and he's got 14 touchdown passes this season, and people are just taking him away at this point.
Dustin Garrison weaves his way to the 43-yard line. Bailey was kind of doubtful. He healed up, though, they thought, during the bye week. He's had a bad ankle. Came in with 59 receptions, 800 yards, and the nation's leader, as you mentioned, with 14 touchdown receptions.
When we saw West Virginia against Baylor earlier in the season, Geno Smith had just a tremendous amount of time in the pocket, and that was Petros, how they got the ball down the field. He's able to just sit and wait and wait and wait, and then all of a sudden, bang, Bailey popped open deep down the field. He doesn't have that type of time right now. So, Petros, I just don't think they can go down the field. It's got to be underneath routes. You've got Copeland in the slot, number two. You've got Austin in the slot opposite him, number one.
They hand it off to Austin. Little shovel. Oh, what a turn on a dime. Hits the midfield. Coming the other way. 20, 10. Touchdown, West Virginia. Joel Klatt, I think Houdini lives. Tavon Austin did things that just you can't do on a football field.
That move in the middle of the run, this is going to go down as actually a pass and a completion and a run after the catch, but that move to go back across the field was just sensational. And then the speed, the electricity out of Tavon Austin to get to the pylon. That's exactly why you got to get the ball to him in space.
Bettencourt with the PAT. We are tied at 14. Yards of magic. Tavon Austin, 14 all. Six plays, Joel, 66 yards. 43-yard touchdown catch. That's the ruling. And West Virginia, after those three straight punts to start this game, they've come back with two straight drives with touchdowns.
Can't get over that run.
Oh,
I guess it was a run after the catch. I mean, it felt like a handoff, right? You know,
it did.
That jet sweep, but I mean, my goodness. Tell Tavon Austin is fresh after that bye week.
Kick is away, short, taken at the 2-yard line. Dawson. He's tripped up at the 22.
When he got around the end, it didn't look like much was there, and that's that turn back. Stanley Maponga, one of the best defenders in the Big 12 Conference, he was the one pursuing from the inside. Watch number 90. He's going to be coming across, and it looks like he's got him dead to rights, and just bang. He just moves. He just shifts a little bit. That was unbelievable.
That's vertical to horizontal in a half a step.
And then the speed, the straight ahead speed to get to the pylon.
Oh, he's a special player. Under 10 minutes to go, first half. Little throw out to Catalan, freshman. Oh, you heard the pads pop at the 26.
Petros, that was one of the more impressive runs I've seen all year long.
Well, there's no doubt that Tavon Austin, also known as Awesome here, is a showman of a football player. I mean, this guy is really flashy. And I got to be honest, I've never seen a cut like that work in a college football game. That is a high school cut through and through. How did it work?
Well, Petros, you called this game that I'm about to bring up. That cut reminded me of Reggie Bush versus Fresno State
yeah.
In 2005. That was a very similar type of run.
But all the way across like that. I mean, all the way. I'd never seen it.
Yeah, that was sensational.
Second down, six. Boykin, far side, pitch and catch, little nifty move. Boyce having a nice first half. We saw Dana Holgorsen upset with his defense earlier, very animated. And I think he is, he's jumping for joy after that touchdown.
You know, he's been upset with his quarterback. He's been elated with his defense. That's been flipped as well. And Dana Holgorsen right now riding the roller coaster of emotion of a Big 12 football game.
First and 10 as we roll up on 9 minutes of play in this first half. Then some wild moments as Catalan gets the carry again past the 35 to the 37-yard line.
This is an important series for TCU after a run like that, the electricity that went through this place here in Morgantown. Now to try to establish that ball possession, time of possession, grind it out style of offense, and you're starting to see that take hold now. A quality run on first down for Gary Patterson to set themselves up on schedule at second and six.
Boykin shotgun. Play clock to seven, gets the snap away. Boykin option, makes a cut. Cartwheeled at the 37-yard line. Let's get a game break back to Los Angeles. And here's Patrick O'Neill.
All right, Craig, other Big 12 action. Well, I figured it'd be a shootout in Texas. Texas Tech in Lubbock, only fitting. Joe Bergeron, 2-yard touchdown run. That puts Texas up 14-7. But Red Raiders are driving, still in the first. Longhorns up 14-7. Craig and Joel.
Thank you, Patrick. Here we're tied at 14 in Morgantown, under 8 minutes. And the bell chimes again. On a third down and five. Five on the play clock, down to four. Got a flag. False start.
Number 56. 5-yard penalty. Third down.
Oh, a false start.
That was Joey Hunt, the backup center. True freshman from El Campo, Texas. Moves to offense from defensive tackle earlier this season. Now he's in the ball game. I mean, this is the youth that TCU is dealing with. He's a backup center, having to play out at the guard position with James Fry solidifying that center position, who is the only senior up there.
TCU pitching 50% on third down conversions, 3 of 6. Boykin in the pocket, pressured, lets that ball fly. It was maybe deflected the line of scrimmage, but it floated, incomplete. And now the pressure, West Virginia, you can tell, playing with much more confidence on the defensive side.
It's a high-risk, high-reward style of defense where they're going to pressure quite a bit. And Boykin had the brunt of that on a third and long. Azima is the one that got in there to hit him. He's trying to find Boyce down the field, was unable to do so. And then they got a punt away.
Punt, fair catch. We're going to see flags. Clearly saw the arm up, waving for the fair catch. And then the contact was made. That was Gamble, and he gambled.
Personal foul, unnecessary roughness on the kicking team. 15-yard penalty. First down.
And Joel, the replay clearly shows the hands up. He's waving it. He's waving at you.
Yeah, he's a really experienced returner, Tavon Austin. And that's as clear as it's going to get. And then Gamble brings him all the way to the ground. I don't think that he gets a personal foul, you know, if he just kind of bumps into him and then realizes. But he clearly just had no idea that that hand was in the air from Tavon Austin.
71 penalty yards per game. And that's something that you just have to cure. You cannot allow that to happen. West Virginia, back to that hurry up. Bowie in the backfield with Geno Smith. Second and seven. Geno slings it in traffic. Dangerous pass, Joel. 1, 2, 3 white jerseys right on the spot.
They were trying to go to Copeland, the freshman. He's only 178 pounds, and I thought he heard the footsteps there.
And again, unable to get the ball, Joel, to Stedman Bailey, number three. They are shutting the door on the outside for Stedman Bailey. Third down, seven for West Virginia. Geno Smith looking his way, throws up top. And that ball through the hands of Copeland. So that brings up a punting situation, fourth and seven.
Ball was on the money. Copeland's got to make that catch. That's two straight snaps that Copeland had a ball thrown his direction from Geno Smith. both were dropped. They both probably should have been caught. That's what you get when you're getting through that inexperienced out in the skill positions. Guy like Copeland, just a freshman out there for some of his first snaps of his college football career.
Bittencourt will punt again at his career high against Kansas State of 49 yards. This one floats up high. Ball is out! West Virginia covers up at the 9-yard line. Nana Kyrum, freshman, Johnny on the spot, special teams.
He was a three-star prospect and a track champion in high school. It's the anchor of his relay team in high school, and that's why he was down there so quickly and able to take advantage of a huge TCU mistake. This is a program built on sound play, much like Kansas State under Gary Patterson the last 10 years. And they've made a couple of big mistakes here in this second quarter.
Geno Smith with a first and goal, throws it to the flat. Bowie hit hard out of bounds, and they'll mark him at the 5-yard line.
Here's the fumble. He never got it.
No.
You see that ball was never secured by the punt returner, Sky Dawson, the senior. And now West Virginia into the end zone. Boy, I thought he almost broke that tackle. Didn't you think he was going to get into the end zone?
At the 2-yard line, Bowie, 188-pound sophomore out of Jacksonville, Florida, came in averaging about 4.8 yards a carry. And now third down and goal. They'll place the ball just inside the 3-yard line. Clock runs, under six to play. First half, eight on the play clock. It rolls down to six. Geno Smith under center. Takes the handoff, play action on the rollout. Geno Smith heading to the sideline. Hurdles in, short at the 1-yard line. The pursuit by TCU. Kevin White came in strong. It's going to be fourth and goal. West Virginia lines it up. Geno Smith under center. Handoff. Touchdown, Alston. Alston running on one leg. Rumbles in and puts West Virginia on top. Point after good by Bittencourt. And West Virginia struggled early. They've got a 21-14 lead, and Dana Holgorsen pumps the fist. It's a 7-point lead for the Mountaineers. Well, the momentum, Mr. Momentum, has changed here in Morgantown. There's a 21-14 lead for the Mountaineers after the fumble punt on a fourth and goal. They run it in, and West Virginia up by 7. Sky Dawson, no return, 5 yards deep.
Let's go back to the play that set up that score. Sky Dawson back, the senior, to receive a punt. You can see he never caught it. The ball was bouncing in his arms from the get-go. And then West Virginia on fourth down, the big back, Sean Alston, with the bruised thigh, gets into the end zone. Tavon Austin, Sean Alston celebrating in the end zone. Dana Holgorsen, he's pumped up. That's a big swing of events there for West Virginia in a very short time.
There was three straight possessions, three straight punts to start this game. Now West Virginia up by 7. Back in the air, ball tipped incomplete as Boykin went over the top to Josh Boyce, who really owned the first quarter for TCU.
Josh Francis, he had the pressure on Boykin. And this offense right now, they had that beautiful drive early in the game with a couple of third down conversions. But Petros, they need to find that semblance of a run game early in the downs.
Well, they need to get back to that. They need to get Catalan going or Andre Dean. I'll tell you what, Gary Patterson is one of the all-time grinding college football coaches. And he needs an all-time grinding drive right now to keep Geno Smith on the field.
Right now, Andre Dean sets up right side of Boykin. Balls out, still out. And it looks like Dean was able to cover up and get that ball back for TCU.
There's the challenge. You're trying to run the zone replay, and it's a stretch zone replay where the running back is going out wide, running horizontally. And if the quarterback is not sure-handed with the ball, and if there's any indecision whatsoever about the take or the give at the mesh point, that ball is going to end up on the ground. And now TCU in a very precarious situation. Third and 19. Look for some pressure here from West Virginia. They've been getting after it all day. This is a prime spot to get after the quarterback.
Four wide receiver set, Boykin shotgun. Third down and 19. Pressure, Boykin throws up top and it's incomplete. He was looking for Brandon Carter and now the Horned Frogs will have to punt down seven.
The pressure was applied by Doug Rigg. And it was actually just a three-man rush. They dropped back into coverage. But Doug Rigg on a three-man rush, there was a little bit of a stunt run. He goes from his inside position to his outside position. Excuse me, not Doug Rigg. That was Azima. Dozy Azima, the junior from Pomona, New York. He's the one who got around the edge, coming from the defensive tackle position around the defensive end.
Perry with a nice boot. Austin dancing, and he is cut along the sideline. He's still dancing. Can he stay in? Now he's out of bounds at the 32-yard line. His stop-and-go ability, I've never seen anything like it.
Just kind of makes you hold your breath, right, every time he has the ball.
Make sure you stay tuned. Coming up on the Pizza Hut Halftime Report, number 3 Notre Dame. Can they stay undefeated? Bounce-back win for the Gators and undefeated Ohio State. The Buckeyes under Urban Meyer in action. Mountaineers start this drive at the 32-yard line with Dustin Garrison in the backfield. And Geno Smith. Little play action. Oh, Geno looked up, and guess what? He saw David Johnson, number 53, right in his grill.
This is just an energy sack. Blows through the block, the left guard, and just kept going and kept going and kept going. Last year, a freshman All-American. 2011, and now the sophomore David Johnson wreaking havoc on West Virginia.
Copeland to the 30-yard line.
There was Johnson again with a tackle. He's running all over the field. He's going to take a break now and head to the sideline. But David Johnson, the sophomore, he's done a heck of a job, number 53 so far in this ball game. He's one of those high-motor, high-energy defensive linemen. Coaches love those type of guys. He presses the pocket from the interior. If the offensive line is not very stout at the guard position in pass protection, he can actually get to the quarterback like he did a couple of snaps ago.
Play clock to 6. Empty backfield, Geno Smith shotgun. Pressure from the edge. Steps and fires. He drags it underneath. The ball on the hands of Austin. And how about that? Smart. Clock stops. He gets the first down. And Tavon Austin, Joel, right now by himself is electrifying this crowd.
And that's why you don't want to run man coverage. TCU was caught in man coverage there. And when Geno Smith sees man-to-man, he goes immediately to his slot receiver, Tavon Austin. Joel Hasley, the middle linebacker, the sophomore, he had no chance trying to chase Tavon Austin across the field.
There's no question that Dana Holgorsen wants more points before halftime. That ball slapped out of the hands of Geno Smith. He's up with it, breaks a tackle, and then is brought down at the 42-yard line. Right back to the line of scrimmage.
That was big Stansley Maponga getting to it, and that's his big right paw reaching out and slapping that ball out of Geno Smith's hands. Geno Smith giving him a lot of credit for getting that ball and back up to the original line of scrimmage, though.
Quick throw, far side, Copeland. And power. powers his way near the first down. They're going to mark him out just about a yard shy. A host of white jerseys from the secondary. You talked about Mpunga. We were told he's going to play in situational plays, but he's been out with foot problems. Harrison.
Looks like he's short there.
Short by a yard.
Yeah, they're going to keep him short by a yard, and at a minute 18, Dana Holgorsen's got a huge decision to make. Who's going to go for it?
Fourth down.
I think he's going to call a timeout. He's going to let this play clock dwindle down and call a timeout.
He's got two to use. Why not?
Cooler heads are going to prevail here. The proper play is to punt this ball away. Up by 7 points at the 49-yard line. Go ahead and punt this away. He's going to turn to the official, Dana Holgorsen, at about 3 seconds, 2 seconds now. Call the timeout is exactly what it's going to do. He just didn't want a lot of time on the clock when he gave the ball back to TCU. Now he's going to talk about it. Now he's a bit of a gambler himself, so I don't know if he's going to actually punt this away. I think he should, though. That would be the proper play.
While we have a moment, let's answer our Aflac trivia question. Earlier, we asked who is the only Heisman Trophy winner in TCU history. We've got the answer. Got a turn the clock back, 1938, Davey O'Brien. First quarterback, by the way, to ever win that trophy, and now we have the Davey O'Brien Award.
And the Big 12 loves the Davey O'Brien Award. Five quarterbacks from the Big 12 are on the official semifinal list for the Davey O'Brien Award, and they are going to go for it. I was wrong.
He's
Dana
a gambler.
Wrong.
He's gambling on fourth and one, under a minute to go and a half.
Yeah, this is a quick kick formation.
Especially when your quarterback fumbles that snap, and for a moment you had to hold your breath.
He wasn't going for it. Derek Kindred, the true freshman number 26, he was the one that was running in on Geno Smith and missed the tackle. He was going to quick kick it. Once that play was broken, that's when he took off. He wasn't going for this. Here it is again. Watch Derek Kindred. The true freshman missed the tackle. He was blitzing, and Geno Smith was going to kick the ball. Kindred was going to block it if he would have kicked it, so he tucked it and actually got the first down. What a break for West Virginia.
Second down and seven. Bowie in motion. Smith pedals back.
TCU's got to do something about this matchup. They've got Joel Haslett, number 36, matched up on Tavon Austin right now, and that's a matchup that they will not be successful in, and they've done that. They've switched him over, and he's now on the Oakland side, top of the street.
Fresh downs, first and two. The ball is knocked away inside the 20-yard line. Mpunga, again, second time on this series he's been in the backfield.
Petro's 15 seconds. You got to start about thinking about going towards the sidelines or towards the end zone.
Yeah, just try to get a field goal at least. You know, I'm surprised, Joel. Geno Smith not known for his running ability, but he's been pretty elusive at the top of this game.
Well, this time it's on the ground and tripped up is Bowie. I don't know if they're trying to set up for a field goal try on the near hash. And timeout, Dana Holgorsen with 2 seconds to play in the half. So make sure you stay tuned. Coming up, it's a Pizza Hut halftime report. Aaron, Joey, Eddie, busy day. I mean, this is week 10 around college football.
We've known for a long time November 3rd was going to be a fantastic day in college football. Those games tonight going to be absolutely tremendous. We got a terrific game here brewing, 21-14 here, heading in to halftime with a potential field goal up from Tyler Bittencourt.
You look at his numbers, Joel, 3 of 5 field goal attempts this season. He's 41 yards is as long as he's had one blocked and has not put a leg on a football in the last two games. Mark it at the 40. This will be a 50-yard attempt. Long enough. So from 50, Bittencourt misses, and West Virginia heads to the locker room. And after a slow start, the Mountaineers lead by 7. ...21-14 our halftime score. West Virginia on top. Now let's send you to the Pizza Hut halftime report. College football presented by Reese's. Just moments away from quarter number 3 here at Morgantown, and after a very slow start, TCU and West Virginia, the Mountaineers on top 21-14. Craig Bullerjack and Joel Klatt, and turnovers really hurt both these clubs in the first half.
Because points off of turnovers on the opposing side, and it started with Geno Smith with a really poor throw down the middle of the field that was picked off by TCU, and they took advantage. This was the post pattern that he was trying to get to. Well off the mark, and right away, Trevon Boykin, bang, he finds his wide receiver in the end zone for the touchdown. Now, this was later in the half, the fumble punt, which led to a fourth down attempt, and there's Sean Alston finding himself in the end zone and a 7-point lead for West Virginia. So the team that takes care of the football best in this second half is going to have a great opportunity to walk out of here with a win.
You look at the first half numbers, a lot of plays were snapped in half number 1, 46 by West Virginia, 31 by TCU. The ground game, Joel, really kind of non-existent in the first half of play. But you're right, the turnovers hurt and helped both these teams in the sense of getting points off those turnovers. 21-14 as we start the third.
Now you got to credit the offenses as well, because they took advantage of those opportunities. Trevon Boykin finds his wide receiver, Josh Boyce, and that was Sky Dawson who dropped the fumble. He's back deep now on the kickoff. We wonder how he's going to shake off that effect of losing that fumble that led to the Mountaineer touchdown.
Well, TCU will have the football as we start the third quarter. And Boyce, 4 yards deep, brings it out. Skips out of one tackle, but cannot escape at the 20-yard line. And Petros, you talked to both coaches. Let's start with West Virginia. I'm guessing Dana Holgorsen has kind of a mixed emotion about this first half.
You're right, Bowler. You guessed right. He likes the way his defense is playing. Doesn't think they're making enough plays on offense. Wants the backs to pick up their feet. Now, Patterson on the other side, he was happy, but he does not want his offense to be in third and long situations. That hurts the young quarterback. And defensively, he doesn't like the way they're giving up the big play. Obviously, that's the formula to beat West Virginia, Joel. Keep them in front of you and tackle.
Yeah, they got caught in man coverage a couple of times, and that really hurt them in the first half. He's going to have to stay out of that being zone the rest of the game.
Boykin starts his half on a play-action toss, and it's Cam White with his first reception of the afternoon at the 25-yard line.
I thought West Virginia in the first half did a great job of getting to the young quarterback, Trevon Boykin. Whether they were getting to him with the ball and actually sacking him or not, he was constantly under duress. Now, he made a couple of nice throws down the field, especially 2 on a scoring drive on third down. But that constant effect of pressure is going to cause Trevon Boykin to have to step up in the pocket and really play with some moxie in this second half.
Third down and 5. Tucker, the ball carrier, finds a hole right side. First down and more. 40, lowers his pads, and he'll get to the 45. Now, was he there? Because the ball didn't come out. The ball is out. West Virginia recovers. Jared Barber, number 33. That ball was out on the turf. Carl Joseph made the hit. Barber covered up Mountaineer football.
Carl Joseph, number 8, the true freshman, comes all the way over. This will be a great look. Boy, that was close, but it did look on that first look, Craig, that the ball was coming out before Tucker's elbow actually hit the ground. I'm sure that they're going to take another look at this because it was that close, and they will. So they'll go upstairs and review this. Now, of course, Matthew Tucker, the senior, he's battling an ankle injury. You saw actually in that clip his right ankle wrapped up very tightly. Been trying to stay on the field. He's been in and out of the lineup.
This is what the replay official, Terry Turlington is looking at.
Boy, it looks like that ball was loose before that elbow hit the ground. I think this is going to stand up. There's just not enough evidence to overturn this for the TCU perspective.
He turns his back here. That ball right
there.
It's
coming out before that knee hits. That right knee was the first thing to actually hit the ground. That ball was coming loose.
I would agree. And his official review. If this play stands, the second turnover in this game for TCU.
And Petros, right after we start saying that they can't turn the ball over, here's the official call here.
Field is confirmed. Fumble recovered by the defense.
Petros, we just got done talking about the turnovers and how in the first half they were really taking advantage of from the West Virginia perspective.
Yeah.
They got, and then bang, they put the ball on the ground on the very first series.
On the road in a conference game, you can't do it. And that's tough for Tucker. He's been playing great. He's had a great career, but he's injured. And it's hard when you have an injury to think about ball security.
And Petros' drive starts inside TCU territory, 46. Pitch and catch, Austin, and he's tossed down. I don't see a flag. You get a little chippy out there.
Petros, interesting what you just said. You're running back yourself. When you're injured, it's tough to think about ball security. What do you mean by that?
Well, you're worried about that injury, and you're thinking about it when you hit the ground, and you're not thinking about holding the ball. I mean, we might see it also with another guy coming off an injury for West Virginia, Sean Alston, who had a pretty good first half. I mean, you said it, Joel. He's dragging that leg around. But when you have an injury and you're banged up around this time of year, you think about the injury sometimes a little more than you think about your assignment.
Alston just picked up a first down at the 36-yard line of TCU. Play action, Geno Smith throws, incomplete. One to Tavon Austin, and again, a dangerous pass, Joel. And he tried to force that in.
He very much tried to force that in. Joel Hasley, here's the middle linebacker. He has him kind of face guarding him right there. Ola Bowden was right over the top, so he can't go over the top either. That was double coverage on the best player for West Virginia.
Austin trying to hit the edge, turns the corner, flags out, and he's bumped out of bounds inside the 35-yard line.
Fields
holding, offense, number 67, 10-yard penalty, second down.
That's the left tackle, Quentin Spain.
Devontae Fields, the true freshman, he right away, he's kind of on a knee, and he's looking at the official like, come on, where's that flag? I know I was held. And sure enough, it came out. Devontae Fields. Oh, he is a heck of a player now.
Joel, he is special. Freshman, true freshman, Martin High School, down the road from TCU in Arlington. And he was an early commit.
Yeah.
But he was a high, big-time recruit.
Could have gone anywhere in the country. Anywhere in the country. And wanted to stay close to home, very close with his mother. Went down the road to TCU.
Second down at 20. Geno Smith dumps it out. That's Copeland with the catch. I thought he was going deep. You notice he kind of pulled back a little bit and went underneath.
It's tough to get behind this secondary because they are so assignment sound. Every snap, very similar to Kansas State, who West Virginia just played 2 weeks ago. But they're always in the right position. Two high safeties. They never get beat deep, so you're forced to throw it underneath that as a quarterback.
Third down and 14. Smith, pocket collapses, escapes. 40-35, and Geno Smith is tripped up. Hasley, the middle linebacker. And again, he was pushed out of the pocket. You know who's been in that backfield a lot today? Mapunga.
And he's another one of those great players up front. He's a junior, and he and Fields had an opportunity. Geno Smith landed on the ball. That's what you saw him hunched over as he went over to the sidelines. Wonder if that ball actually knocked the wind out.
Bittenkirk is going to try another field goal. He missed for 50 just before half. This will be for 52. Got it! He came out early. He was hitting them from 40, 45 before we started the second half. And from 52, it's a 10-point lead for West Virginia. Fox College Football is sponsored by Reese's Peanut Butter Cups, the perfect combination of chocolate and peanut butter. And by GEICO, 15 minutes could save you 15% or more on car insurance. 52-yarder. Geno Smith cracking a smile. It was not that way early, Joel Klatt. First three possessions ended up in punts for West Virginia. They've got a 10-point lead. Last drive, six plays, 11 yards, and they got three more points off the turnover.
Yeah, they've had the benefit of getting those mistakes, those turnovers from TCU.
Dawson. Nice run back to around the 25-yard line. Let's get a game break back to Los Angeles, and here's Patrick O'Neill.
Okay, Craig, thanks very much. Pitt at number three, Notre Dame. This was supposed to be a cakewalk for the Golden Domers. Ray Graham, 16 yards. Pitt, incidentally, only 75 miles away from Morgantown, and they lead 10-6 late second quarter. Greg and Joel, still work to do for the Irish.
Notre Dame, that perfect season, kind of wobbling a little bit. Now TCU with work to do. They got off to a fast start. Now down 10. First possession of this third quarter, and not much. Maybe a half a yard past the 25.
This defense has just flat played so good today as compared to what they have been for the rest of the season. Joe DeForest, the defensive coordinator, first year from Oklahoma.
Weather Service in League City has issued a severe thunderstorm warning for extreme northeastern Montgomery County, central San Jacinto County, extreme southeastern Walker County until 4:45 p.m. Central Daylight Time. At 3:55 p.m. Central Daylight Time, Doppler radar indicated a severe thunderstorm capable of producing damaging winds in excess of 60 miles per hour. This storm was located near Cut and Shoot, or 7 miles east of Willis, and moving north-northeast at 30 miles per hour. Conroe reported a wind gust to 61 miles per hour. Locations impacted include Cold Spring. Severe thunderstorms produce damaging winds in excess of 60 miles per hour, destructive hail, deadly lightning, and very heavy rain. For your protection, move to an interior room on the lowest floor of your home or business. Heavy rains flood roads quickly, so do not drive into areas where water covers the road.
Brandon Carter, the intended receiver, and Carl Joseph did not give him much space. And not a very impressive offensive series for Boykin and company.
But you got to credit West Virginia. I mean, the sense of urgency that they're playing with right now, they're playing fast. They're making more open field tackles than we've seen all year from the Mountaineers. And Dana Holgerson's got to be thrilled with what he's seeing from that side of the football. And he spent a lot of time with them over the last couple of weeks. Everybody thinks he's just an offensive-minded coach, which he is. He spent a lot of time with that defense.
Fair catch by Austin. You make a great point. Holgerson said, look, I made a few stops in practice and in the defensive line room. I'm hanging around. They know where I am. Back in Morgantown, West Virginia, 11:09 to play in the third quarter. Mountaineers up by 10, 24-14. Really check out the West Virginia leaders, and Geno, 21-32, nothing fancy, had the pick, but a couple of touchdowns.
And I thought Sean Alston's return was going to be a little bit bigger than this. He's had the 5 rushes for 13 yards. He did get into the end zone, but Tavon Austin, he's been the spark plug on offense, 8 catches, a long touchdown catch. It was really a handoff, but he was just electric after the run.
First and 10, Geno Smith and company, big hold up the middle. 9-yard gain for Garrison on first down. Petros, right now is kind of a defining time for TCU's defense.
Well, they're on the ropes right now. They need somebody to make a play. Devontae Field.
This station is activating the Houston Area Emergency Alert System at the request of the National Weather Service, because of a severe thunderstorm warning for Montgomery County until 4:59 p.m. Again, this station is activating the Houston Area Emergency Alert System at the request of the National Weather Service, because of a severe thunderstorm warning for Montgomery County until 4:59 p.m. This concludes activation of the Houston Area Emergency Alert System.
series, Petros, for TCU's D, helped out by the play calling of West Virginia.
Dana Holgorsen really angry with that offensive line, just letting him have it all the way from the numbers to the sideline. Man.
Betancourt will punt at his own 21. Sky Dawson awaits. Ooh, low snap, Boston. Still loose. Picked up. Touchdown, TCU. Dominic Merck. On a cold day in Morgantown, a low snap, and Betancourt could not get his hands around that football.
West Virginia has a true freshman long snapper, John DePalma. 6'6", 235 pounds, and that was just a poor snap on a cold day. Those guys stand over there forever. They don't move around. They're not loose. And he goes out in a big situation and makes a huge mistake, and TCU capitalizes in a huge way. If Dana Holgorsen was mad at his offensive line, he's going to be even more upset with his special teams after that miscue.
And the points off turnovers continuing to be one of the big, big talking points in this football game.
Betancourt probably could have gotten that ball away, but after he dropped it the first time, it was over. TCU was actually coming up to the punt, and Merca gets into the end zone. Wow, what a huge turn of events, because right when you thought West Virginia, they had the defensive stand, they've got the momentum, their offense is back on the field. It's second and short, and from second and short, it's two run plays, get stopped for no gain, and then a negative play, and then a drop snap by Betancourt leads to a touchdown for TCU. The swings and momentum in this game have just been enormous.
It's been up and down. There's DePalma on the headset. 24-21 West Virginia. Mr. Electric, Tavon Austin back to receive. Little squibber.
They're not even going to give him a chance.
Why? But instead, they still give West Virginia five field position at the 35-yard line. Well, tomorrow on Fox NFL Sunday, the Cardinals will be in Lambeau. Lambeau Field to take on the Pack, or the Panthers, Redskins, Bears, Titans, or you could see Lions and Jaguars, or the Vikings will take on the Seahawks as both teams look to bounce back after a tough loss, or the Bucks and the Raiders. Coverage begins tomorrow with the Built Ford Tough Fox NFL Sunday pregame show, noon Eastern, 9 a.m. Pacific. Geno Smith rolling the flat out. A little slip on the sideline, but a flag's down.
Holding on the defense, number 56. 10-yard penalty, first down.
West Virginia's going to get completely bailed out. I want you to watch the wide receivers on this play. They absolutely thought that this was going to be a run. Geno Smith and West Virginia's offense clearly miscommunicating, because J.D. Woods wasn't even looking back, and Geno Smith is back there trying to throw the football to him. So the wide receivers and the quarterback not on the same page, but bailed out enormously by a holding call on the defense.
Second hold on TCU's defense in this game. Here's a quick pass far sideline and wrapped up quickly is Stedman Bailey. Where has he been today? We talked about it earlier, Petros. I don't know if it's been as kind of a decoy, but finally Bailey gets his hand on a football.
A decoy for a bunch of series? I mean, we didn't know Stedman Bailey was going to play. He's been out there but doing nothing. That's the second time Geno Smith has targeted him, and he finally makes a catch.
Second down, five. Good protection. Oh, dangerous play. Coming back, Verrett. Nearly had an interception, number two for TCU.
I think he was trying to find Bailey again. He's working against Jason Verrett, the Big 12's leader in interceptions. Limping just a little bit. You saw him kind of hop on one leg, and he didn't get any explosion back to the football. It almost allowed Verrett to get back and intercept that ball.
That would have been his fifth interception of the season. Third down and five. Geno Smith flushed out of the pocket. Pulls it down. Little stutter step. Oh, he's going to be close to a first down. Mapunga was in that backfield again and chased him out.
Now that yellow line is not official, but it sure looks like the spot of the ball is going to be short of the first down marker. They need to gain the 44-yard line. There is an injury on the field. That's David Johnson.
He's on two knees and getting the help up.
He's had a really quality game. One of those motor guys. I was talking about him a bit earlier. Grew up around the Fort Worth area watching TCU. Was one of the bleacher creatures when he was a kid. Petro said, I don't know if Dana Holgerson's going to go for this or not, but his offense still on the field.
Well, I think he wants to go for it. They need to get that rhythm. You know, Joe, last time we saw West Virginia, everything was predicated on that first down, and then the rhythm flowed. It just doesn't feel that way this time around.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. They've had a real hard time with their rhythm.
On a keeper. Holgerson's been the gambler in this ball game today. Fourth down, that makes it now 3 out of 4 on fourth down conversions. Nothing like the keeper.
Well, especially when your quarterback weighs 220 pounds. And here's this helmet rule affecting play once again. Geno Smith came, his helmet comes off, and now he's got to come to the sideline, and the backup quarterback has got to be on the field. Just a rule that sounded good on paper, yeah, that has just been absolutely atrocious when it's put into practice during actual gameplay. This is Paul Millard, the backup quarterback, sophomore.
Comes in cold.
This is going to be a handoff. Absolutely. Oh, my goodness.
Backside pressure, and he throws incomplete. That is, again, a very dangerous call. The offensive coordinator, Shannon Dawson, but you get a cold quarterback coming off the field, play action, and he wants to throw it middle of the field.
Petros, I cannot believe they allowed Paul Millard to throw a pass right there, completely cold off the bench. That's nuts.
Dana Holgerson never fails to surprise.
Well, Geno Smith back in after the one game rest, but he throws to the near side. It's caught by J.D. Woods. Time for a game break. Here's Patrick O'Neill.
Okay, Craig, thanks very much. Ole Miss at Georgia. Rebels actually led 10-0. Aaron Murray buying some time, 40-yard strike. Tavares King, look at the fans going crazy. 14-10, Bulldogs up on Ole Miss. They are at the half. Craig and Joel, back to you.
Oh, the sea of red, Bulldog country. Here is 24-21, West Virginia. Trying to add more to it. Sean Alston.
Still trying to shake off that pass attempt by Millard. I mean, that was nuts.
I think they were surprised his teammates were, as Geno goes far side, pitch and catch. Austin, little room, that's all he needs, and he still won't go down at the 28-yard line. Boy, he is an energizing young player. Love watching him try to work his way into trouble. Pick up a 5. 7 minutes to play in the third. Geno. Tough throw. Austin, the intended receiver. Joel, you're the old quarterback. I think it's one of the toughest throws in football.
Especially the short out route to the field or to the wide side. Now, if it's a little bit of a deeper route, then you've got a better angle. But when it's a short out route, only 5 yards deep, 6 yards deep, that angle is incredibly tough because the defender is actually right between you and your wide receiver.
Eighth play of this drive. Smith tried a high hurdle. Boy, he is taking some punishment. He went flying, took a hit in the hips.
Petros, there's your guy, Devontae Fields, coming in again. The true freshman has just done a heck of a job getting to Geno Smith during the course of this game.
Yeah, and TCU is known as a defensive team. I mean, that's the strength of what Patterson coaches. And you see him bow their necks a little bit here in this drive. But this guy's been on a roll. This kicker, strong leg.
Yeah, Bittenkirk back on after booting a 52-yarder. They'll place this down at the 33. This will be a 43-yard attempt off the far hash. It kicks away. No good.
This is no good.
Timeout in Morgantown. 6:12 to play in the third. West Virginia by 3 on Fox. And we take you on a little drive through Morgantown, the heroes of West Virginia. TCU with the football down three, 6-12 to play in the third. Boykin goes back to work. Throws, deep ball up top. And now a flag is tossed. In fact, it's littered with yellow. Boyce, the intended receiver, and he got tied up with Pat Miller. Multiple flags. That ball did hang for a while.
Back judge and the field judge chatting about it. They're going to go talk to Scott Novak, the white hat here, the referee today.
Here's the call.
There's fouls against both teams. Pass interference on the offense, number 82. Pass interference on the defense, number 6. Penalties offset. First down.
I wondered why there was such a discussion going on. If both of them had the same penalty, they would have just run right in and it would have been called. But you're going to see Boyce. You see his right arm. That's the grab of the jersey that draws one penalty. And then at the end, when Miller doesn't allow Boyce to get back to the football, that's where the second penalty comes in. Correct call. That's a terrific job of officiating by this Big 12 crew to talk about it and get the call right and replay the down.
Yeah, let's do it again. First and 10 at the 26-yard line. West Virginia creeping up, showing blitz. Boykin in the pocket, throws again, and deep ball, same pass. And it's incomplete. Boyce, the intended receiver, they decided to try it not once but twice.
And Petros, this feels like panic to me from TCU. When they're best, they just got to run the football and stay very basic with Trevon Boykin.
Yeah, I think they have that ability. I don't understand the deep throws.
Gary Patterson, 12th year, 114 wins, the all-time winningest coach at TCU, from the sideline, 8 on the play clock, second down 10. Boykin gets a snap away, has to put it in his hands, wants to run, now he throws on the run, and coming back to help is Cam White, but again, flags are out of the 25-yard line. Boykin looks like he was roughed
up. Personal foul. Roughing the passer on the defense, number 31. Contact to the quarterback's head and shoulder area. 15 yards will be added to the end of the play. First down.
This has been one of the best officiated games that we've seen all year. Clearly a late hit there on redshirt freshman quarterback Trevon Boykin. Let's bring in Mike Pereira, our officiating expert, our officiating insider. And Mike, these guys doing a heck of a job. The double pass interference, they got the late hit correct there from Scott Novak.
Hey, Joel, I got to tell you, and only once in my career have I seen offensive and defensive pass interference. That was the best call I have seen all year. And that's also a good shot on the head of the quarterback, because that's just that punishing blow on the head and neck area.
How about that comment, Mike? I mean, you have been around so many years in college and in the pros, and to make that comment is the first time you've seen it.
It's, you know, I saw it one time in an NFL game called by the same official, called both offensive and defense, and it was correct. But this one, I've only once seen it. And this, to me, two different officials making the two different calls, and both are exactly right. Fascinating. It's one of those plays that will actually be used as a teaching tool for a very long time.
All right, Mike Pereira, thanks for that great insight. As we go back to action, Boykin got the ball out. In the hands, Boyce breaks it inside the 10-yard line. Boyce has been a big-time receiver in this ball game, and bailed down Boykin on that throw.
The thing that impresses me about Josh Boyce is his strength. You watch the strength going up in the air, then coming back down, the balance to stay on his feet, and the strength to break a couple of tackles and get that ball inside the 10-yard line. That's exactly why he's TCU's all-time leading touchdown catcher. 5 catches in this game for 86 yards and that touchdown. He's had a heck of a day.
He's flirting with his 6th 100-yard career day. First and goal at the 8-yard line. Hand off. That hole was big, but it closed in a hurry. And it was Catalan, the freshman, is chopped down. So 4:12 and the clock runs here in Morgantown, West Virginia. A slow start by the hometown Mountaineers, but they got the 3-point lead. A
with Craig Bowlerjack and Joel Klatt, Petros Papadakis, our sideline insider. Glad you're with us here on Fox this afternoon. Big 12 battle, 21-ranked West Virginia trying to hold on. And we got a player down at the 10-yard line. Training staff's on the field, taking a look. We'll step aside and take a break here on Fox. Shaq Rao was the injured player, was able to walk off the field under his own power. Let's take a look at today's four-game summary. Points off turnovers, well, it was 14-10 in favor of TCU. Total yards, West Virginia 246, and Geno now over 10,000 career passing yards. Redshirt freshman, Trevon Boykin, under center. Second down goal, TCU at the 6-yard line. Quick hitter off the right side, and Matthew Tucker stacked up maybe a yard to the 5-yard line.
You know, I don't love that play call. Let me tell you why. They were on the left side of the middle of the field, which means with a right-handed quarterback, you can throw a big play-action fake over the left side of your formation and then boot your quarterback to the wide side of the field. You got a lot of space out there. But just handing the ball off into the middle, now you create third and goal from the 4-yard line, and this is a play that you must pass. I don't think there's any way that they can hand this ball off. So this ball is going to be in Boykin's hand. He's got to make a play.
We got a loaded backfield, 3 seconds on the play clock. Got it away. Boykin throws, dart, picked at the goal line. It's in the hands of Isaiah Bruce. First interception of the season for Isaiah Bruce. And that pick really puts the brakes on a TCU drive.
And it was such a good drive. And Boykin made some great throws. He wasn't afraid all series long to try to fit that ball into tight spaces, but this time it backfires and Gary Patterson can't believe it. Got to be so frustrating. Dana Holgerson on the other side, elated with the fact that his defense, again in a crucial situation, making a huge play.
Seventh interception of the season thrown by Boykin. And just when you think the Horned Frogs are going in to go on top, it's a turnover. Geno Smith back to work. We'll start the drive at the 12-yard line. Tough catch by Garrison around the shoe top.
And Craig, that's why I talked about that second down play call. It was forcing the hand of the offense. When the defense knows that it's going to be a pass, they can play the soft zone coverage even at the goal line and drop those linebackers into the slant zones.
You just saw that graphic of the red zone troubles for TCU. They pitch it back to Austin, breaks a tackle, and there's a hold back inside the 10-yard line.
It's going to be a hold on Andrew Bowie, number 13.
There is no foul for a block in the back. There was contact the entire time. Third down.
Boy, I thought Bowie had a big grasp of the jersey of Devontae Fields, number 95, who looked like he was going to stop that play for about a 5-yard loss. But now still a third down and long situation.
Third down at 12. Shotgun, Geno Smith. Pressure from the edge, fires, and that ball's incomplete. And West Virginia now will punt away, and TCU, Joel, will be guaranteed very good field position off this punt.
It's still frustrating that you turn the ball over in the red zone, but this is a big reason why we haven't been calling Stedman Bailey's name all day long, and that's Jason Verrett, number 2. This guy is a terrific player. He's leading the Big 12 coming into today in both passes defended and interceptions. He got an interception again in this ball game. That makes 5 on the season for Verrett. He's played tremendous today.
Dawson took a hit right at midfield. Did not wait for a fair catch. And so the Mountaineers with a big hit. Carl Joseph provided the lick, the free safety.
How about the true freshman, Carl Joseph? He's a pretty good player. If there was a player performance index, I think he'd be pretty high on that.
Let's introduce the UPS Team Performance Index. It's a new statistical measure that looks at the efficiency of a team's offense, defense, special teams, miscues to define their competitive advantage. You can check out the UPS Team Performance Index throughout the year for a look at the logistics behind a winning team. Quick hitter, Cavallon. How about that first down run off the right side? Picks up eight.
Do you see the explosion there, Petros? I think it might be time to feature a guy like B.J. Cavallon, the quarterback. Trevon Boykin throws a red zone interception. I think it might be time to sit there, settle down your team by handing the ball off to a guy that's clearly got a little explosiveness to him.
Yeah, and I like the look of Tucker, 6'1", 227, but he's been banged up. Cavallon's your leading rusher right now. He's been in the program since January. Let him run the ball. Get him some rhythm.
He enrolled early. He was at spring football, so he knows the system well. Again, Cavallon, the ball carrier, and a first down at the 38-and-a-half-yard line. A true freshman, Westside High School in Houston.
He was rated the number one all-purpose running back in the state of Texas. Just a true freshman out of Houston, like you said, Craig, but leading this TCU team in rushing. Now, he didn't think he was going to have an opportunity to play. They had three running backs coming into this season that they thought they were going to ride to maybe the deepest running back core in America. Ed Wesley, Waymon James, and Matthew Tucker. Ed Wesley went into the supplemental draft. Waymon James, he tore his ACL, and Matthew Tucker hasn't been able to stay on the field with that ankle injury.
Boykin back to work, play action. And throws out in front of David Porter. Now they lost James early, by the way. Waymon James, September 15th against Kansas on the road in Lawrence. And so you're right, Cavallon has been given the opportunity and has taken advantage of the situation.
Ed Wesley was a 1,000-yard rusher the year that they went to the Rose Bowl and ultimately beat Wisconsin. Then Waymon James, their leading rusher from a year ago, and all those guys coming back, including Matthew Tucker. A lot of people talking about that was the best backfield in the country. And now all of a sudden you got a true freshman, B.J. Cavallon, in the game on the road in a conference game.
Pitch out.
Battle on the ball carrier.
So under a minute to play in the third quarter. Clock is running. Third down and five. West Virginia's defense trying to get their fans up on their feet.
This big down here. Yeah. This is a huge down here.
Listen in. Boykin rushed that throw. It's incomplete. Cam White, the intended receiver, and Pat Miller's done a nice job. Both the corners of West Virginia have been very active today. So what do you do? Fourth and five, late here in quarter number three.
You trust your kicking game. I think that you try to kick this field goal. Now, my view is very skewed. When I was playing, I had a guy named Mason Crosby as the kicker. He could make it from 70. This is probably the correct decision for Gary Patterson, knowing what his kicking game is like, to Jaden Overton.
Fourth and five. Boykin, flush, using his legs, has room. First down, and his cartwheel to the 25. Shaq Petaway made the hit. That's one thing Boykin brings to the table: athleticism and a great pair of wheels.
And a huge decision. We talked about managing the game coming in, and that is managing the game. Trevon Boykin, the redshirt freshman, picking up the biggest first down of the day for TCU. They'll have it when we come back, down by three.
Back in Morgantown, West Virginia, Milan Pushkar Stadium. We're about another row or two up there.
That's right.
Stadium. I'll tell you what, entertaining game. I have a feeling as this game continues on, whoever doesn't turn the ball over will walk away with a win.
It seems to be about mistakes at this point. Which team is going to step up and not make the big mistake? We've seen the big mistake in the red zone from TCU on their last series. But now they get an opportunity right back, and they're moving the ball well.
On the option, Boykin, hit, spins and is down to the 16-yard line. Now Boykin started slow. I like the way, though, he's kept his head about himself on the football field. And you know what he's done? He's trying to play within himself. And again, it's going back to running the football. That's what he does so well.
Especially on that third down. That third down was just enormous. And these two defenses have played so well today. The season averages for total yards you saw there for both in the offense, well below that today.
Second down, just over a yard. Option dive, Catalan. To the 13-yard line. So fresh downs for TCU. They had a great drive the last time they were on the field, but then remember, Boykin threw the interception at the goal line. They're right back on the front porch.
And this is where I'd like them to get to that play action game, get their young quarterback outside of the pocket on a designed rollout. What that does, Craig, gives him a run pass option. He's more comfortable running the football, but if it's there, he can use his arm.
Three wide receivers near side on a pitch out. Catalan. And this time, West Virginia's D stays home. They saw it coming. Carl Joseph, nice game today out of his free safety spot.
I don't love option this close to the goal line because the safeties are closer to the line of scrimmage, and they're the alley player. So a safety's responsibility when an option play is run is he runs through the quarterback to the pitchman. It's called the alley. But when he's closer to the line of scrimmage, he's obviously right there to defend the play. Very tough to get a hat on him, blocking him from an offensive perspective.
This will be the 10th play of this drive, second down nine. Another option play, and this time Catalan was buried by Josh Francis, the Buck.
Another pressure dialed up by Joe DeForest, the defensive coordinator. I thought it was the right read from Trevon Boykin because there are so many defensive players there. You don't want to pull that ball out. You just give it to your running back, but the offensive line unable to open up a hole. And this is the exact situation that they wanted to avoid, the obvious passing situation with their young quarterback inside the red zone.
Eight red zone turnovers this year. We saw one on the last series. Play clock to two, play clock to one. Just got the snap away. Boykin stands tall, runs out of the pocket. 10-yard line, little stutter, and he is tossed out of bounds at the 8-yard line. Petaway and Cecil Level, and Level, he was leveled out of bounds. Now what do you do? Let's kick it.
Yeah, absolutely. You take the tie right now. You take the points. You figure that's a given with your kicker, Jaden Overcrom, earlier this year at 6 field goals in a game. He's the Big 12 Special Teams Player of the Week, but it is just a true freshman.
Yes. This is last two after making 10 in a row. Little chip shot up and good. We are tied in Morgantown. TCU 24, West Virginia 24. When we roll back, Geno Smith and the Mountaineers back on the offense. Fox College Football is sponsored by Aflac, official partner of the Heisman Trophy, and by AT&T, the nation's largest 4G network. AT&T, rethink possible. Morgantown, West Virginia. It's getting a little nippy outside.
Temperature has definitely dropped. There's no question ever since even the kick from halftime.
24 all TCU, 21 ranked West Virginia, 12:01 to go. And the Horned Frogs kick away. Keep it away from Tavon Austin. So, Petros, I'm going to know, how do you stay warm on a cool, cold day in Morgantown?
Well, guys, there's no question that the weather down here has affected the game. You saw it on the dropped punt and the touchdown for TCU. I got my Fox hat on, but also the Mountaineer, he hands out deer jerky down here, and it's delicious. I've eaten like 12 of them.
That's how you stay warm?
Yeah, you should see this guy. He's in the full buckskins and he hands out food. Is there another mascot in college football that hands out deer jerky?
No.
Absolutely not, no.
Is it good?
It's delicious.
That's how you stay warm on a cold day in Morgantown.
I wouldn't know if it's good. My tongue is frozen.
Geno Smith dances out of trouble on his back foot, throws. Dangerous pass, always out. In and then back out, incomplete. And Stedman Bailey, his rough day continues. And right now, Geno Smith trying to go to his go-to man.
Sam Carter with the defense, he's the safety. Never really had it there. Tries to catch it late. Stedman Bailey's just not right. I mean, you can tell that injury has severely affected his ability to impact the game.
Just one grab so far in this game. Second down, 10, clock stopped with 11:51 to go. Bowie past the 30. Bowie out of Jacksonville, Florida. We've seen Dustin Garrison in the backfield as well. And West Virginia will line it up, Joel, third down and 2. Just 5 of 16 on conversions, third down today. Two wide receivers, top of your screen. First down. Bowie crashes past the first down marker, and a game break back to L.A. Here's Patrick O'Neill.
All right, Craig, thanks very much. Georgia starting to open things up on Ole Miss. Aaron Murray, 42 yards to Malcolm Mitchell. Mitchell, start of the year as a cornerback, now returning kicks and scoring touchdowns. Craig and Joel.
That's one diverse young man. Georgia looks like they've taken control as Bowie races up the middle again. There's a pickup of 5, Joel, on first.
And first down success. They told us they went back in a self-scout. They looked at every time that they punted. Only 2 times they punted this season when they actually got positive yards on first and second down during that set of downs.
Another quick hitter, not much. Bowie is taken under by a wave of white led by Devontae Fields. Also Hunter, Chucky Hunter, defensive tackle. Both have played very well up front. Hunter goes 305, Fields just 240, but boy, he is all over the place. 14 tackles for losses, as you mentioned, number one in Big 12 play. Smith flushed. Tried to throw a sidearm, and that is a dangerous play by what would be a very smart quarterback, and a hat comes off of Chucky Hunter, and that means he's going to have to hit the sideline for a play.
And it was just a 3-man rush for TCU, and they still got to Geno Smith. The coverage down the field was absolutely tremendous. Number 54 comes in late. He was just spying. That's Marcus Mallett playing for Joel Hasley at the middle linebacker spot. He's the one who hit Geno Smith there at the very end.
Bittencourt will punt. At his own 30-yard line. Sky Dawson awaits. Pressure comes. It kicks away. Good hang time. Fair catch. 24-yard line. Got a good one, Bruin, in Morgantown. 9:56 to play. We're tied at 24. And the emotion of the West Virginia Mountaineers and the Horned Frogs of TCU down the stretch on Fox. College football's biggest championship games return to Fox Friday, November 30th. It's the Pac-12 Championship live in primetime. And Saturday night, December 1st, the Big Ten's best take the field to see who will be crowned champion. The Pac-12 Big Ten Championship games only here on Fox. TCU with the football, first and 10. Andre Dean, big game. Move the chains, 39-yard line, knocked down by the free safety, Carl Joseph, true freshman from Orlando.
How about the true freshman, this right tackle, Avion Collins? He makes the hole there, but then it's Dean who just takes off and gets north and south and goes straight ahead. Too many times you see running backs tackle themselves by stopping in the hole, trying to cut before they need to. Dean doesn't do that. Finds himself moving the chains for the first down of the series.
110 yards on the ground now for TCU. It's been a struggle ground-wise for West Virginia. Flags are out and fingers are being pointed.
False start on the offense. Number 69, 5-yard penalty. First down.
Avion Collins, another freshman mistake in crunch time.
First true freshman to start on the offensive line for Gary Patterson. in his career at TCU. The penalties have hurt. There's no doubt, because when these teams have gotten behind schedule, first and 15, first and 10, second and 10, those types of down and distances, the defenses has just had tremendous success. Now, in this situation during the game, Joe DeForest has loved to blitz Trevon Boykins.
Play clock to four. Play action. Boykin over the top. Oh, just off the fingertips of Josh Boyce. And that stops the clock and brings up a second down and long. Let's get a game break from the Big Ten. Here's Patrick O'Neill.
All right, Craig, Illinois at Ohio State. Braxton Miller, just take a look at this work. Miller has already thrown for a touchdown in the game. He's going to run this one in. So that's one and one. In fact, he's 13 running the ball, touchdowns, and passing on the season at Heisman Quest right there for Ohio State's Braxton Miller. Craig and Joel.
Thank you, Patrick. What an athlete. It's amazing what Urban Meyer continues to do with schools and football programs in his first year. Bowling Green, Utah, Florida, and now Ohio State. It's amazing. Mr. Fix-It.
Helps when you got a guy like Braxton Miller.
Yes, it does. You got a guy named Alex Smith in Utah who's at San Francisco with the 49ers.
Boy, how about this for a critical down?
Third down and 10. Ball's at the 39-yard line, and the clock running up on 8 minutes of play. 24 all. Flushed, tucks and runs, weaves his way for a first down and steps out of bounds. They're going to mark him at the 49. And this young man, he felt the pressure from the edge and he took off.
Well, you see his running ability. He has got tremendous legs. The cut right there to split the defenders and then move the chains. His first week is starting after Casey Paul Hall got dismissed from the team to enter drug rehab. He was actually a running back that week. They moved him to running back the week of the Iowa State game for 2 days. Paul Hall gets the DUI, gets suspended from the team. Trevon Boykin got 1 day of practice before his first start this year as a starting quarterback for TCU. Went in there, did all right. They ended up losing the game. They were undefeated going into that game. They lost to Iowa State. He comes back against Baylor, was very efficient in a 49-21 win. And now in just his third road start of his career, he's showed a lot of poise and done exactly what Gary Patterson has asked him to do, which is just manage the game. And when it's there for him to run, he's done that and gotten some huge conversions out of it.
There was some speculation whether or not Boykin would play today with a left leg injury that he suffered late in that Oklahoma State game, but he's played terrific. Slings it down, field in traffic, up goes. Nope, they're going to wave an incomplete on the hands of Boyce. And he had possession, but not long enough. It's incomplete at the 30-yard line.
Petros, it's pretty clear that for a young guy, he's locked in with Josh Boyce, because Boyce has been in some traffic, and he still tried to go there.
Yeah, he tries to fit it in a window, and Boyce has pretty strong hands. You know, you're talking about Boykin's running ability, Joel. He does have the lead of a tailback when he takes off with the football. I mean, he leads to the sticks and really gets his legs going. I really like this kid. I think on third down, they should move him outside to the wide side, see what he can do.
I agree. Get him out of the pocket, but out of an empty set. That's very hard to do without a play action set, so this is going to be a pocket pass.
Third down and long. Boykin, the rush comes. Slings it, incomplete. Behind Andre Dean.
Boy, he had him. Dean was wide open in the middle of the field. Boykin gets away from the rush, up to the line of scrimmage. The rush got to him pretty quick. A blitz by West Virginia. Keeps his eyes downfield. The ball just behind the intended receiver, Andre Dean, who can't go back and catch that ball.
Perry will try to pin West Virginia back. He short. That's a little short kick at the 20. Call that the 15-yard line. So he pooches it, and no return for Tavon Austin. Geno Smith back to work when we come back on Fox. Fourth quarter in Morgantown. 6:34 remaining. 24 all tied. Fans, tell us what you think and vote on the college football social poll of the week. Which undefeated team will be next to lose? Could be Bama, Kansas State, Notre Dame, Oregon. You can log on to facebook.com/Fox Sports to cast your vote, and we'll have some results a little bit later. I've been looking at the scoreboard, and I'm not going to reveal.
I'm just going to cast a vote for C, Notre Dame.
C, okay.
Is that all right?
Yes, I think
you're cheating a little bit.
No, I think that may be a safe pick, by the way. Second out 10. Right side of the power of Alston. Got a little slow start. I thought it took a little while to get the legs warm. And he was limping early in the first half. And he's had some powerful runs, and the big body comes off the field.
236 pounds.
And replaced by Bowie.
This offense just hadn't looked the same the last 3 weeks. We saw him against Baylor. They racked up over 600 yards of passing. They just.
Smith throws that ball up over the top and off the hands of Bowie.
Another example, Craig. You know, that play is open. I mean,
yes.
It's there. And an inaccurate throw from Geno Smith. That ball is on the chest, or framed up, as quarterback coaches like to say. If you frame that ball up, Bowie's going to run forever. He had the edge. The defense was leveraged. Barrett was on the inside covering a slant. He's going to maybe hit his head on the pylon of the end zone.
And that's what was happening in the first five games of the season. Everything was wide open for West Virginia, and the reason why they averaged 52 points a ball game. Dawson pedals back, 35-yard line. Spins out of one tackle. Going the opposite way, trying to hug the sideline, still on his feet. That's a great return. When we come back, we will see Trevon Boykin and the TCU offense next on Fox. Fox College Football is sponsored by UPS. Let UPS put the power of logistics to work for you. Now the lights are on, and it's cooling down in Morgantown. But Dana Holgorsen is one heated coach. 24 all time under 6 minutes ago. Back to work goes Catalan, the freshman tailback for TCU.
They've had more success when they get Andre Dean or B.J. Catalan going downhill. You know, this stuff on the edge against this 3-4 hybrid style of defense that West Virginia is playing under Joe DeForest just really isn't working. They've got too much athleticism on the outside. But when they've gotten downhill and tried to crease them, they've had a lot more success in this second half, rushing for 107 yards.
A pickup of three, second down seven as we hit the five-minute mark. Carter goes in motion. Nothing. Catalan, maybe a yard. Let's get a game break. Busy day. Here's Patrick O'Neill.
Yeah, the rankings about.
Patrick, thank you. You make a great observation that the polls will go upside down again this week.
Yes, they will. Seems like every November.
Yes. TCU third downs in this ball game. 4 of 14. They need 6 to move the chains. Boykin, shotgun. Out of the pocket, pressure. And will not escape West Virginia's defense. Maybe one of the biggest, if not the biggest, play of the game.
And this defense, so much written about, talked about the fact that they couldn't stop anybody. Last in the country when it comes to pass defense coming into today. 362 yards a game. And they have played their butts off. You talk about emotion from a defense, rising to the occasion from a defense, playing with a sense of urgency. They've done that today here in Morgantown.
Perry, big punt. Austin, watch out. 50, 40. Austin, goodbye. Touchdown, West Virginia.
76 yards. Electric. Push-ups, I'm counting. We're at a 29, 30, 31. Here it is again. A couple of double moves and right there gone.
And that's why he was the Big East Special Teams Player of the Year a year ago. So dynamic, so electric. He has put the Mountaineers on his back today. The touchdown in the first half with the electric run, and now the punt return in the second. Tavon Austin now 200 all-purpose yards against TCU today.
Waving the town.
He's dancing.
Oh,
he's
dancing
for everybody.
A lot of football left. 3:18 to go. TCU with Brandon Carter on the return. Oh, he's knocked back at the 15-yard line. Well, you like what you're seeing here. How about tonight after our game? Fox College Saturday doubleheader continues with a Pac-12 showdown. Fourth-ranked Oregon looks to keep their national title hopes alive as they will battle 17th-ranked USC. Coverage of Fox College Football presented by Reese's follows here on Fox.
And my hope for all of you watching is that that game is just as good as this one has been.
Test Joel Platt for Trevon Boykin, the redshirt freshman quarterback from TCU. He's flush from the pocket, uses those legs and picks up maybe 6 yards at the 20-yard line.
Petros, Tavon Austin has just been the West Virginia team today.
Yeah, he's the king of West Baltimore, Maryland. Elite speed, and that's why he's so great in the short passing game, Joel. It's that acceleration, that burst that we saw there. You don't see that with a lot of players. Really special.
Three wide receivers stacked up top on second down and 4. Slingshot it. It's going to be incomplete. It was Catalon, the intended receiver, but a little bit low. Third down and 4. And the bell chimes again here at Morgantown.
West Virginia has been great on third down today. They came in 117th in the country. They've been great against the pass. They came in dead last, 120th in the country. This defense has risen to the occasion. They were challenged during their bye week, and another opportunity in front of them now on a 3rd and 4.
They empty the backfield. Boykin with 5 wide receivers. Mountaineers show blitz. Here they come. Quick throw, far side. It's a hop and a skip. Catalon incomplete, and Will Clark and company, along with Kyle Rose, brought the heat.
That's just poor offensive design. Trying to throw hot versus the blitz all the way to the outside of the field on third down, backed up on your own 20-yard line. That's not what you want your quarterback trying to do, especially a redshirt freshman. You have to design inside hot routes, side adjust routes that will go north and south and take advantage of vertical seams created by man-to-man pressure. TCU's been unable to do that. Dana Holgerson's got to be thrilled with the defensive production he's gotten from Joe DeForest's unit.
We'll keep it here. You see the timeouts remaining. TCU still with 3, West Virginia with 2. And time now for today's Reese's perfect play. What could it be?
Yeah,
but
that's easy.
But the punt return.
That's easy.
For Mr. Austin.
Brought this stadium down. And right when they needed it. Off the huge third down stop from their defense. We talked about the passion that their defense played with. And Tavon Austin's going to get another opportunity right now.
Ball is punted and it is shanked out of bounds.
And they're going to mark it at the 47-yard line.
I can see why you don't want to punt towards him. I mean, look at how Tavon Austin has completely turned this game around. First half with his long reception, even though it was just kind of a shovel pass in the backfield. The punt return, now they're kicking it away from him, giving the offense great field position. This is what a tremendous ball player will do for your ball club. He affects every facet of the game.
2:31 to play. A job now for TCU. Stop Geno Smith and Tavon Austin. They go right to Tavon. Now remember, the Horned Frogs with three timeouts. And they'll use one here. And we'll step aside. Timeout in Morgantown. Back to live action. West Virginia. They go outside. Austin, they spread him out. And what looked to be, Joel, what could have been a big gain. They push him and knock him down to the 50-yard line. Another timeout used. We'll keep it here. So one timeout remaining for TCU. And coming up after our game, don't forget the AT&T Fox College Saturday Game Break Show. A lot to talk about. Of course, updating that potential upset. Notre Dame, number 3 in the country, undefeated when they walked in the stadium today. Big 12 breakdown. Also, the look ahead, the primetime matchups, and plenty tonight in primetime.
Ask me, November, crazy stuff always happens. I mean, Pitt is beating Notre Dame on the road in South Bend. I don't think that Alabama and Oregon get out of tonight unscathed. One of those teams is going to lose on the road, either Alabama at LSU or Oregon at USC.
Bold predictions.
Well, it would have been bold if I said which one. But.
Yes.
Leaving it open in there.
Nope, didn't get the snap off.
Before the snap, delay game, offense, 5-yard penalty, third down.
Never understood that, how an offense and a quarterback and a play caller can allow that to happen coming out of a timeout. Never quite understood it. And this puts them well behind the chains now. It's going to be somewhere in the neighborhood of 3rd and 13.
And there's still over 2 minutes to play, and TCU has a timeout. 3rd down, 13. Two wide receivers, top and bottom. And Bowie in the backfield with Geno Smith. The play is saved. And Bowie is taken down at the 47. Chucky Hunter. And Mallett, number 54, in on the stop. And a final timeout now used by the Horned Frogs. Aaron, Joey, Eddie, they're ready.
Got a lot to talk about. Good day in college football already so far, and Oklahoma took care of business here in the Big 12 up in Ames. I thought that might be a trap game, but it was going to be tough for Iowa State. Jake Knott, their terrific linebacker, was actually out with an injury this week. That was going to be very tough for the Cyclones to stop a high-powered offense, especially a week after a loss. You know, you get the full attention of a team like Oklahoma the week after a loss. But here in Morgantown, we got a great one. A redshirt freshman quarterback, Javon Boykin, with about 2 minutes left, no timeouts, against a defense that has just flat found itself today in West Virginia.
Bettencourt will punt inside his own 35-yard line. Good snap. Kicks up. Line drive at the 15-yard line. So the last drive, most likely of the day for TCU, and it belongs to the redshirt freshman. Travon Boykin. No timeouts remaining with 2:07 to go. And Joel, 85 yards away.
And for TCU, they got to find some opportunity to get the ball out of his hand quick, because Petros, that West Virginia defense, they've blitzed him and been attacking this entire second half.
Well, if they win, they will have won with special teams and defense today, not their high-powered offense. But does Boykin have enough to lead this team on a drive to tie it up?
They got to help him with the play calling. If they're going to continue to pressure like this, they got to get the ball out of his hand fast.
Boykin, chopped down at the five. Josh Francis exploded up the middle and took him down. I don't know if Boykin saw him.
Now no timeouts, must work in a hurry up type situation. And this further emboldens Joe DeForest to come after the quarterback.
Loss of nine in the end zone as Boykin sets his feet. Out of the pocket, slingshots it downfield, has a man at the 40, big room to rumble. It's Boyce, 30, 25, 20. Boyce, goodbye! Touchdown, TCU! The impossible, 94 yards.
Here's Boyce, and he gets completely left free, pushed out of bounds. The hat was on the field for him going out of bounds, but they find him behind the defense, and he goes all the way in for the touchdown.
94 yards, and now the extra point to tie this game. And Dana Holgorsen cannot believe the chains of event.
And this defense played so sound all day long. They didn't get beat. They didn't have missed assignments.
Flags on a play, on the play, on the kick.
They have a false start here against TCU, but they played so good all day long. And then
false start, offense, number 89. 5-yard penalty, replay the try.
This is a big extra point,
oh,
too,
is.
To keep pushing them back like this.
I mean, if you don't make this, the 94-yarder doesn't mean much. This is more than just a little chip shot for a PAT. 31-30, minute 28 left. And the kick is up and splits the uprights. We're tied at 31.
Let's take a look back at that touchdown, and it starts with Trevon Boykin and his ability to escape pressure. You see the guy at his feet, he escapes and gets out. Now right here, this is when both the safety and the corner start worrying about Trevon Boykin as a runner. And at that point, Boyce is left wide open on the sideline, and that missed assignment causes Boyce to have green grass in front of him to the end zone. Just a blown coverage by West Virginia's defense. Cecil Level. Cecil Level was a walk-on, awarded a scholarship. This is the first game that he's ever started in his college career. The safety, number 24, a senior from Fayetteville, Georgia. He had to change positions. He wasn't even a safety before this year. So here's a guy that's had no experience seeing a quarterback run out of the pocket for the first time. He takes his human instinct and runs up as a defender and gets burned because of it.
No return for TCU on the kick.
Early 93.
And Geno Smith goes back to work. What looked to be a victory in the bag for the Mountaineers, the 94-yard touchdown. And now we're looking at potential overtime, but remember, two timeouts remain for West Virginia. A minute 28 on the clock and a wild one in Morgantown. Three wide receivers, top of your screen. Smith in the pocket, throws a dart, far side. And right on the button is J.D. Woods. He's out of bounds, stops the clock.
Just to clarify, the rule between college and the NFL is much different. If you're forced out of bounds in college football like Josh Boyce was on that touchdown play, you're eligible to touch the ball first. In the NFL, that's actually not the case.
Smith, short side of the field, and they work it out of bounds again. Woods with another catch.
Boy, lots of time left, two timeouts, and all they need is a field goal. We've already seen Bittencourt make a 52-yarder today. He did miss a couple of field goals on the day. He's 1 for 3.
Right now, West Virginia using the sideline to their advantage, but they do have two timeouts. There's an option. And Geno Smith pulls the ball. That ball's down. Did they blow a whistle? I didn't hear one. That ball was out before a whistle. Mallett's got the football for TCU.
They ruled that day down based on forward progress. Both linesmen just came in for the spot, started signaling for the chains to move. Now with 1:05, the clock will wind, and West Virginia's in business.
Under a minute to go, 31 all time. TCU and West Virginia. Set it up for a field goal opportunity, and Booey, oh, pushes the pile to the 40, call that the 39, maybe the 38 yard line. How about that forward progress and the push
and
up front?
They're at least in field goal range at this point. It would be a 55 yard field goal.
Quick snap. Smith sets and fires that ball, nearly picked off after it was batted away by Sam Carter.
Kyle's going to want pass interference on Sam Carter. They're trying to force the ball into the slot. I believe that was Tavon Austin, number one. Sam Carter, number 17, had him by the back of the jersey. I think he got away with one there in order to get to that ball and bat it down. Bittencourt getting loose on the sidelines. 1 for 3 today. This is going to come down to his foot.
And you notice no one's talking to Bittencourt. Geno Smith looks over the middle of the field, ball nearly picked off. He had a wide open receiver on the far side. That was Booey. He was swinging out of the backfield, but he decided to go across the middle.
Wow, Elijah Olabode had this in his grasp. Boy, that would have gone, and he had a lot of green grass in front of him. That might have gone the other way. A huge mistake by Geno Smith that he got away with.
They're down at 10, 24 ticks on the fourth quarter clock, 31 all time. Here on Fox, Booey in the backfield. Three wide, near side. Now the officials will whistle a timeout. West Virginia will burn their second timeout. They have one remaining. Boy, coaches can pull their hair out of their heads on a game like this. Let's get a game break. A wild day in college football. Here's Patrick O'Neill.
Well, it is not over in South Bend because the Irish are getting back on this one versus Pittsburgh. Everett Golston throwing back. TJ Jones 11 yards for the touchdown. Now they missed the extra point. Still a one possession game, 20-12. Pitt up on third rank. Notre Dame, Greg and Joel.
Thank you, Patrick. Here it's 31 all with 24 seconds to play. 38 yard line at TCU is West Virginia. Geno Smith going back to work. Looks downfield, home run ball. Up top, he goes and complete. J.D. Woods was the intended receiver. He had one-on-one coverage with Kevin White.
Here we go. Bittencourt
hit a 52 yarder. He's 1 of 3 in this game.
They're going to line this up. He'll be kicking it right from the 45 yard line. 55 yard field goal for the game.
And the career long made earlier of 52. Here we go. Good snap, kicks away. No. Never had a chance as he hooked it to the left. And 13 seconds to go. 31 all in Morgantown.
I'm surprised that the offensive play calls weren't trying to help out Bittencourt, getting him closer than 55, because the 52 yarder he made earlier, which was a career long, barely got over the crossbar. A couple of runs there rather than the passes that were incomplete as Dana Holgorsen and Shannon Dawson look on for the potential game-winning field goal. Patterson's reaction.
New life.
He's got new life. I thought they should have run the ball, gotten a little bit closer.
Now Boykin with 13 seconds on the clock before we go to overtime. He's flushed from the pocket and tries to throw that ball as he's down on a knee and completes a call. And coming with pressure was Francis, the Buck, number four.
I think it might be time to just take a knee and play for overtime. You know, the amount of mistakes we've seen on both sides of the ball. I mean, Geno Smith, a couple of snaps before they tried the field goal, he threw it right into the arms of the safety from TCU, and that's exactly what Gary Patterson will choose to do. Take the knee, play for overtime.
Boykin on a knee. And that's what they'll do. Well, what looked to be a West Virginia victory didn't turn out that way, at least to this point. Here's what, this is how we got to overtime. As Josh Boyce just kind of floats around, he's open and gone 94 yards.
And outrun everybody. West Virginia, they had it. And their defense had played so good all day long, even against the pass. They were last in college football against the pass, 120th in the country coming in, 362 yards a game given up. And they had played so well, gotten to the quarterback, Trevon Boykin. Joe DeForest, his game plan, the sense of urgency, the passion with which those defensive players were playing was just tremendous. So to have it happen like that, just a blatant missed assignment in the back end, has got to be frustrating. Both of these clubs with now the momentum clearly on TCU's side going into overtime.
Captains will make a walk to the 50-yard line. We'll get the coin toss.
Okay, rules for overtime. We'll flip the coin again. TCU, you will call the toss. Winner of the toss chooses offense, defense, or which end of the stadium we're going to play on. Each team has one timeout per overtime period. And if we get to the third overtime, if you score a touchdown, you need to go for a two-point conversion. What is your choice?
Choice
is tails. It's heads, you want to toss.
Defense,
what end of the stadium?
Okay,
West Virginia will have the ball at the 25-yard line. We will play on the south end of the stadium.
So here we go. Boykin's on the phone. TCU, West Virginia set for overtime on Fox. Point conversions must be tried beginning in the third overtime. And Joel, the first to lead after a completed round, wins. Both these teams desperate to try to break out of two-game losing slumps. Boykin. Catalan, heart of the West Virginia defense.
That defensive front has been so stout. They had some success early in the second half, speaking of TCU running the ball on that defensive front, but in the last four or five possessions, they've just had none of it. That defensive front has played really well up front. Will Clark, number 98. George Wright, number 99. Those guys have played really hard.
Second down and eight. Shotgun, Boykin, play action. Wants the home run. Up top, man coverage and out of bounds. It was Cam White, number 88, the intended receiver, and Pat Miller has had provided some great coverage on the edge. Carl Joseph comes up limping a bit, number eight. There's a flag out.
It's going to be on TCU discussing what they want to do with head coach Dana Holgorsen.
An eligible receiver legally downfield on the offense, number 87. Penalties declined. Third down.
This is the end of the play. Not very close. Great defense being played by West Virginia. That was number eight, the true freshman, Carl Joseph.
five wide receivers. Third down today, 4 of 16. Quick slant. Not much. Carter. Taken down at the 20.
Putting the game on the true freshman's foot. Jaden Overgroom will come out. Been good today, but has missed some field goals in the past couple of weeks for TCU, and a big one here.
Hit from 26. His numbers this year, 15 of 19. We'll mark this down at the 27. This will be a 37-yard attempt. No. So now it will be West Virginia's turn.
And you'll probably see some very safe play calls. Jaden Overgroom now 50% on the day. Good snap, good hold. Just came out of the kick too soon. Wanted to see it and hooks it left.
Now it's Geno Smith in West Virginia. In overtime, their first possession, 25-yard line, first and 10. Quick throw. And trying to break out of the tackle is Traveris Copeland, the freshman. He makes the grab, 5-yard pickup.
And as an offense, the entire offense, as a quarterback, the leader, you got to just tell everybody, ball security, be safe with the football at this point.
Second down, Sean Olsen in the backfield. Geno Smith flips it out. That ball batted down, incomplete. That brings up third down.
John Kuntz, I think, got his hands on that ball, number 97. And batted it down, and you can tell Geno was hesitant to go down the field on that one. He wants to make sure if they're going to put the ball in his hands and he's going to put it down the field that he's got a completion. Doesn't want to put this ball at risk. And now with Sean Alston in the backfield, I think you might just see a run and a field goal attempt.
Third down at 4. Quick throw, far side. Little pitch and catch, Copeland again. And maybe a yard to the 19-yard line. Now remember, Bittencourt Prickert today, 1 of 4 on field goal tries. And Dana Holgorsen does not look like a happy head coach.
TCU's defense does exactly what they needed to do. Force a long field goal attempt. Bittencourt made from 52, long misses, 50 over 40, and then the 55-yarder at the end of regulation.
We'll mark it at the 26. This will be from 36 yards in the win for West Virginia. It kicks up. Verrett, terrific day for TCU defensively. And he comes flying in on special teams. And what we will do here will go to a second overtime.
He had an interception today. He leads the Big 12 in passes defended. He's got 5 interceptions on the year. And now a couple of missed field goals. And we're going to overtime number 2.
So the second overtime here in Morgantown, they flip flop on offense. So again, West Virginia with the football at the 25-yard line. Both teams missing field goals in the first overtime period. Geno Smith dancing, looking, ball hangs up. Oh, touchdown and a flag down. Stedman Bailey. And let's see what this flag's about.
Pass interference on the defense number 2. Penalties be called. Touchdown.
Jason Verrett has had such a good game against Stedman Bailey. And Geno Smith goes right to him. The first play of overtime number 2. And Verrett's got him locked up on the double move. He's got good coverage, but he never turns back around. That's great execution from a quarterback and wide receiver.
Third catch of the day for Stedman Bailey that puts West Virginia on top in this second overtime. That stop and go move was very impressive by Bailey.
It was, but Barrett still had the coverage. You know, it didn't allow Barrett to go and defend the ball, which was the key to the whole route, as he was in catch-up mode and couldn't turn back and actually defend the ball. 15th touchdown catch now this year for Stedman Bailey. That's first in the country, his 31st in his career. He's the West Virginia all-time leader. And because Barrett was in recovery mode, that's why he couldn't look back and actually get to that ball and bat it down. And Bailey did a nice job, I thought, of not extending his arms and pushing off. It felt like there was an opportunity there late. He had his hands up, and then he pulls them back and just receives the ball. That's a pretty savvy play by a veteran wide receiver.
Yards away. Remember, one timeout in each overtime possession. That's what you need to push a third. Boykin. In round. Now the pass. My oh my. Fuller tied in. Trickery. Touchdown. PAT to come. Playground. You just ride it up in the dirt.
Brandon Carter with the touchdown pass. Unbelievable. Petros, the resiliency of this team, unbelievable with an important PAT to come.
For such a young team, you just can't imagine how they keep on bouncing back in this football game. What can you say about Coach Patterson and his team and the way they keep on rising from the dead, so to speak, here on the road?
The reverse pass from Brandon Carter. Here he is lined up on the left side. The ball is handed off in the backfield to Catalan, the true freshman. Goes back to Brandon Carter, the sophomore. He drops it over the top to Corey Fuller, the senior.
First touchdown of the year for Corey Fuller. Only his third reception.
Unbelievable. But you got to credit that the offensive play call, they haven't done anything offensively except for the complete blown coverage at the end of the game by West Virginia. And then now some trickery, a creative play call, take the hand, basically the game out of your offensive line's hands, because they've been dominated here in the second half and in the fourth quarter more specifically. And you take it out of their hands, and with a creative play call, it's a tremendous job.
We ran that play when I was
They're
in seventh
for
grade,
it.
And
They're
they
going
are.
For two.
How about this? Gary Patterson rolling the dice. Here is the second overtime. Boykin slingshots it low. Did he catch it? Yes! Josh Boyce! And in double overtime, the gamble pays off. TCU on the road beats West Virginia. Hold it. The celebration, they may bring this back. Review. Joel, I wanted to wait. The official right on the spot put his hands up, and now the review's underway. Did it take a bounce?
Let's take a look. Boykin rolling to his right, throwing to Josh Boyce. The ball is low, tough to see. Looks like it shifts in his hand, in that right hand. It would have been tough for him to catch it in his bicep like that. This will be a better look.
Hands underneath the ball. Oh, that's tough.
Boy, that's tough to see. Craig, there's not enough to overturn that.
How about this angle? Did he trap it? Looked
now,
like it hit off the forearm.
On that angle, that's tough. Petros, did you have a good angle down there?
You know, I definitely saw the ball bounce. Now, whether or not it bounced off his forearms or the ground, it's tough to say. And like you said, with the way his body was blocking the ball, it might not be enough. There is such confusion down here right now, and it's a good job by the officials.
After review, the ruling on the field stands as a completed catch and a two-point conversion. The game is over.
They couldn't confirm it. There wasn't enough to overturn that call, and TCU is going to win a football game.
Here's another look one more time. You feel heartbreak for West Virginia, but elation for TCU. And here it is. Maybe only Josh Boyce knows for sure if that ball took a skip on the turf or not. What a wild one. TCU in double overtime. 39-38 over West Virginia. For Joel Klatt, Petros Papadakis, our entire Fox crew. Craig Bowler, Jack Sane, so long. Let's take you now to Aaron Andrews at the Fox studios for the AT&T Fox College Saturday.